Hello, Michaels. How are you guys?
Hey, dogs. I have a question. Who banked in a three on purpose?
Mark McGuire.
Okay. Do we just believe that he?
Because, Mike, he's what? Mark M.F. Aguirre. Okay. Mike.
Like,
no, that's
double
fair.
Use
fair.
Of my name no. there.
Hold on. If you saw Sirois banking a three-pointer, would you think it's luck?
Yeah. No, I would think it's
would
not
think,
luck.
No, I think he's
skill.
Trying to do that.
Like,
I don't know how often anyone in the NBA has ever intentionally banked in a three-pointer.
That's fair. Now, I am assuming he meant to do it because he was the number one overall pick.
He was so hot.
So damn good. And he went for 27 in the quarter. But I'm pretty sure he meant to bank it in. He was way off on the side. It wasn't a front bank in.
Yeah, it was a corner.
Corner.
Not a corner. Well, it was a 45-degree angle.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I remember that shot. Yeah, he was so hot. And the other thing he did, and I don't remember the number of points, but I believe he hung like 49 or something like that the day after getting snubbed in the All-Star game.
Yeah.
Or it might have been the day of. Like, they announced it at 3 or something, and he went out there and almost hung half a hundo. Yeah, man. He's got a I would be real curious to learn what Rhyner thinks of Mark McGuire, because he kind of had a contentious relationship with the local media there in the 80s.
Well, you're in luck, because Mike Rhyner is sitting right here.
Because I just put on the headset in time to hear the name of the great Dale Ellis invoked.
What about McGuire?
Well, things were difficult for him while he was here and while he was playing. But in his more recent years, I've interacted with him. He's turned into a great guy. He was just a little young, a little immature, probably not ready to be the front man of an expansion basketball team in the remote yet burgeoning southern outpost of Dallas. But, you know, he had his difficulties, but he seems to have turned the thing around. I give him credit for that.
Can you guys see a parallel between the careers or the vibes, the way they're thought of or received or whatever, between Mark McGuire and Juan Gonzalez?
A little bit. I think Wando was a little bit more extreme, but we'll never know that because he didn't speak the language.
Right.
And he didn't care to learn the language, didn't care to interact with anybody who didn't speak the language. But I'd say his case was a little bit more extreme and a little bit more, I guess, if such a thing can be sad, his was the sadder of the two.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, Mark forced his way out of here and went and won championships with Detroit. One of the things I do remember, though, is because during that time period, you know, Ben and I are junior high and high school age. And when you're that age, especially before the era of social media and every game being on cable, your opinions are very much shaped by the opinion makers, and Galloway had an axe to grind with Mark McGuire, and so that very much impacted how I felt about McGuire and did all the way into my adult years, and that didn't change until basically Derek Harper told me I was wrong. He was like, you're wrong to feel this way. His teammates didn't necessarily feel this way. Now, I think Rolando has a little bit different take. But, you know, Derek loves Mark, and Derek thinks Mark should be in the Ring of Honor. And one time I did a podcast with Harp and Mark McGuire, and it was incredible. I mean, I was just in awe of, like, if you had told 15-year-old me I'd be sitting here with Harp and McGuire talking about this as Harp's in his jersey's retired and McGuire's isn't. And Harp is a big advocate for McGuire, and so that made me a big advocate for McGuire because I think we all of us love Harp and respect Harp to a great degree.
Yeah,
to a huge degree. And I'm right there with him. It's going to be hard for those who are around at the time maybe to let some bygones be bygones because, you know, Mark on several occasions just flat out let the team down.
Right.
You know?
Right.
But there were also a whole lot of highs in there. And there was a lot of great basketball, a lot of scoring, which is essentially what he was. He was a scorer. And I don't know, I think somewhere in Mavericks lore, that's got to be recognized. And I can scarcely think of a better place to do it than hang the number.
He was the greatest player on an expansion team. What in the city of the Dallas Cowboys. How difficult is that, you know? So... Anyways, what is happening on the Downbeat today, gentlemen?
Well, we're going to make you sweat, man.
You're damn right.
How are you going to do that?
Going to get your body soaking wet.
Nice.
I'm already sweating after you guys revealed my home address on the show not too long ago. I appreciate that. Then I just went to Skin's website, and I noticed
That's
my blueprints are
That's
on there.
Nobody knows their way around Oak Cliff. Don't worry about it.
No, I've had people... I've had a random listener knock on my back door.
You have?
Yeah, who was visiting the Lee Harvey Oswald former home and staircase.
And they decided they would cap their Oak Cliff day off with a visit to the home of the psilocybin sea cow, huh?
I'm like, in my boxers, I'm like, hello? I don't know if they thought I'd just be partying. I don't know what they thought I was going to be doing.
Did you invite them in to burn one with you?
Yeah, I was burning one. No, I had boxers on, probably had the Xbox headset on, and walking like, can I help you?
Oh, man. What a bad experience. Well, gentlemen.
Yes.
You guys have a wonderful show. We're going to shut it down from here at Pluckers.
Oh, my gosh. They want to get out of there.
Yeah, really? We want to go. But listen to the Downbeat 3 to 7. Thank you to all the nice folks that stopped by, including Mike Rhyner, Jeff Cavanaugh, and Julie Dobbs. Coming up next, the Downbeat right here on 97.1 The Freak.
This is... 97.1, The Freak. Good afternoon, everybody. You are, in fact, as the man said, about to listen to the Downbeat. That would be us. I would be Mike Rhyner. And I'm joined by, once again, my life partner, Mike Sirois.
My man.
My guy. At the helm, look. Who it is.
Look at him.
It is Shoopy.
Oh, Shoopy, how are we?
Shoopy. We're fine. How are we?
We are good. Ready to party. It's Friday.
Mike and I have been retired for a while, but you are coming into your first, like, regular weekend. Honest week's work. Make you sweat. And then you get your Friday night, Saturday, Sunday off.
I'm looking forward to it, but I'm also looking forward to being back next week already. Even though we're currently here.
You're trending upward. I heard you knock out that what the freak is going on.
I panicked. Apparently, Skin was all ready to do it, and I just was like, oh, God, we got to get the sponsorship in.
We're going to spring one of those on Mike.
No.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
No.
Hey, just do it. Three things that are going on. That thing's kind of a whip.
No, it's cool.
Yeah. No, I like it, but when you forget, you have to do it.
What were the three things?
Yeah, what were your three things?
The three things were Draymond Green punched his teammate Jordan Poole in the face.
Mm-hmm.
Tia Mowry, the star of the hit sitcom Sister Sister, filed for divorce after 14 years. And Ben and Skin were at a Pluckers on Lower Greenville.
Do you see that Draymond punch?
I know it happened. I haven't seen any
video.
Is there a good video of it?
Yeah, I'm going to give you a video. And you can,
so this happened right like in front of everybody? There was no going outside or anything like that?
In front of God and everybody.
Yep. And country.
All right. Oh, my goodness.
Mike's going to give play-by-play.
Okay.
Draymond Green.
Okay. All right. And three, two, yep. Okay, now we're underway here. He's standing over there on the sideline.
Practice court.
Mm-hmm.
Seems to be a stoppage of play.
Right. Obviously, a little coaching going on here somewhere.
Some chirping apparently happening, too, because there goes Draymond. There's Jordan Poole.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then?
Ooh. Ooh, a shove. Ooh.
All right. That's rookie quality.
I swear, I would not have that guy.
Draymond?
Yeah. Great player, but... he's just too big of a pain in the ass. He's just too much. You take him on, you're taking on a lot.
It is does seem to be always something, but man, he is good.
Oh, yeah, he's great.
And I guess it's hard to argue after watching that video that he's a great teammate. I kind of always thought he was one of those love to have him on your squad, hate him for everyone else.
Well, that may be, but still, I mean, you don't walk up to one of your teammates and just... punch him out like that. Does anybody know what precipitated this?
I did see it, and I don't remember. What was it? I'll try to find out real quick. But as they were talking on the afternoon show earlier, I think it was Ben and Skin, or maybe it was the Speakeasy with Jeff, KT, and Julie. I think it was. It was Julie mentioning.
That is that, not the afternoon show.
No. It was earlier than that. Julie mentioned one of her hockey guys. They were talking about it. And, like, fighting at practice is so common. And it's not abnormal. Now, that is a direct hit. I mean, that's a square, straight-up punch to the nose. And he looks like he dropped him.
Yeah. I mean, that is not a fight that happens because practice gets a little contentious out there.
Mm-hmm.
Like it might in hockey. And I suppose could in the game of basketball as well, although you never see that sort of thing. I mean, that appears that there is some sort of beef between those two guys, and they're spending all of practice chirping back and forth about it. And the time got right, and the more Draymond thought about it, the more it rubbed him the wrong way, and when the time was right, he took care of it in his own unique way.
The one of the rumors spurring from a Chris Haynes Yahoo Sports tweet suggested the incident could have stemmed from a change in Poole's attitude as he negotiates a potential extension with the Warriors. So maybe he's being salty balls or acting like it don't stink or something. I don't know. And Draymond had to regulate.
I don't know. I guess you'd have to be there. And we weren't there.
Do you think Draymond is going to evolve into the next generation Charles Barkley, because he does a lot of TV spots. I mean, they love the podcast thing, and they throw him in front of mics and cameras, and he's good.
Yeah, he could.
And he's smart. He's good on the mic, and he's not funny like Barkley is, but mm-hmm. I mean, he's an interesting dude, and I kind of feel like that is his post-career destiny. But I don't know if things like this hamper that at all or get his name out there even more, you know?
Well, we would have to be around him a little bit more than we are to get any kind of good feel for whether he would really be a nice fit for that. But when Charles Barkley was around, you could see it. You could see that coming. I mean, when he came here, which he only did like once a year for the better part of his career, but when the 76ers came here, if you had a media credential, that was a game that you did not want to miss. And Charles Barkley embraced it. You know, he would come out of the shower and there'd be a throng around his locker and he'd just get in the middle of it and say, "What's going on, fellas?"
Yeah.
I mean, he loved it.
He was always awesome. I do that for some reason like once a year. I don't know why. Maybe I'll be watching Inside the NBA and I'll be, you know, enthralled by something he's talking about, and I'll go back and watch like a YouTube video of his highlights. Like, it's so easy to look at him as just Chuck and funny and gigantic.
Yeah, people forget what a great player he was.
The round mound of rebound.
Yeah, I mean, he was definitely top 10 in his time, maybe higher than that in some years.
Got what, one MVP?
Yep.
Yeah, his best season, he averaged 27.6. But he wasn't that big of a dude. He would rip rebounds right out of your hands.
And he was always real pudgy and everything. Mm-hmm. There wasn't a lot of keeping himself in great shape going on there or anything like that.
Yeah.
But man, he had a great feel for the game, too.
That must feel.
I loved watching that guy play.
And his is well-earned. I like. It must feel pretty good, though, to have such a great career. You know, what, 99 out of 100 or more than that, NBA players, they play their last game and then disappear. Maybe you have enough money to do so, who knows. But if you're lucky enough to then spend the next 30 years, like in his case and Shaq, I mean, these are guys who probably certainly didn't need the money, but in the game, getting paid a ton of money, having fun. Like, what a sweetener to the end of an amazing career to then, you know, it's like Troy even. Yeah. Or any, you know, there's only so many, though. And broadcasting is one way to do it. Coaching might be a more logical way to do it on a lower level.
But there's a lot of stress in that, man. That'll eat you up.
Yeah.
At the end of the game, you get to go home when you're a broadcaster.
Mm-hmm.
But Charles Barkley, I would say, was, during his career, every year, well, maybe not every year, maybe toward the end of the line, things tailed off, but he was a top 10 for sure, maybe top 5 player.
Yep. I don't know if I ever saw him play. I did get to see Jordan play. I don't recall if I ever saw Charles.
Boy, back in the day, it was always a big deal when those Eastern Conference guys would roll through here and play the Mavericks.
Because that was somewhat of a rarity.
Oh, yeah, you only got to see them once a year.
Was that how it was, once?
Yeah. You got to see them once a year. Now, the Lakers would come here through here three times. You would see Akeem Olajuwon three times with the Rockets. And, you know, all the Western Conference teams were here, you know, three or some years maybe four times.
Yeah.
But the Eastern Conference teams rolled through here once. So you had to make that count.
Yeah.
And it was a big deal, too, for the good ones, like the Celtics or the 76ers. Yeah, those were games everybody wanted to go to.
When I was in high school, I was in Sarasota, so the nearest team was the Orlando Magic, so that would be the trek, which is a couple hours of a drive, and then acquiring tickets all the way in the rafters, you know, like who knows, and Jordan tickets obviously pretty tough to get a hold of, but we'd go up to maybe two games a year if we could pull it off. But it wasn't quite as easy. I mean, you kind of forget how nice it is to live right here in a city with this thing, you know, an hour maximum from wherever you're living, if you're hearing this probably. It's pretty sweet.
It is pretty sweet. So you are a Miami Dolphins fan, right?
Yeah.
Why are you not a similar Orlando Magic guy?
When you grow up in South Florida, I'm 46, so there was only the Miami Dolphins. It's kind of fascinating. Think of the state of Florida. I mean, they are loaded with teams in every league, but when I was born, it was before the Tampa Bay Buccaneers even existed, there was literally one professional sports team in the entire state of Florida, the Miami Dolphins. And then throughout the next, you know, 40 years, obviously, you get the Buccaneers and the Jags, then you get the Panthers and the Lightning, you get the Marlins and the Rays, you get the Heat and the Magic, and now it's littered with assorted teams. But when you're a kid, man, all we had was the Dolphins, and that's why across all...
Don't forget the Jags.
Yeah, the Jags were in there as well. So like even to this day, the only singular team in any sport that I truly love and care about is the Miami Dolphins.
You know how many teams we had here when I was born?
How many?
One.
Was that the Texans?
That was the first edition of the Dallas Texans, who were here for part, I think, of the 1950 season, and they moved. They couldn't wait to get out of
really?
Here and became the Baltimore Colts.
Okay, yeah. It is funny if you look at a long enough scale of time, the migration of teams from condensed in the Northeast to trickling westward and then jumping to the West Coast as mm-hmm. a handful of baseball and football teams did, and then the migration south, you know, into Texas, obviously Florida, as I just illustrated, Arizona.
Yeah.
It's just interesting how that slow dance kind of works.
Did I spring my most recent reindeer game on you?
I don't
Tell me if I did.
Okay.
But name a city,
mm-hmm.
a major American city that has never had a sports team move to it or from it. Now,
so we're looking for the largest American city?
Or just any city that's never had a team move to it or from it.
But they have a team?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, they got one now. But
wow.
In fact, they've got all of them. A lot of them have all of them now. But
okay.
Teams that are cities that have never had a team move to it or from it, if you really want to rock and roll with this thing, and it's really a game for idiots, but I'm an idiot, so what? But if you really want to rock and roll with this thing, include hockey, which really screws things up, and include the ABA.
Okay.
Which you pretty much have to do.
Do expansion teams...
Yeah. Oh, yeah. They count.
They count as far as eliminating a city?
Yeah. But I mean, you got to name the city.
Well, I would say Miami. They've received expansion teams, obviously, like in all the sports, I suppose.
Mm-hmm.
But to my knowledge, I don't think any established team has moved to Miami or out of Miami. Is that my meeting the criteria?
Or? Yeah, you are. You are.
Cincinnati, maybe?
No. The Cincinnati Royals were there in the NBA.
Damn
and
it.
You know them today. In fact, they've moved twice. You know them today as the Sad Sack Kings.
All right, I quit this game. I'm sorry.
You've been eliminated. I've never been to Cincinnati. I have an odd interest in going to Cincinnati.
It's nice.
Is it?
Yeah.
Because I went to Cleveland, and I loved it. It was a beautiful day. I know the weather can be very cold and not much, but, man, the day I 2 days I spent in Cleveland, I loved. And I've been intrigued by going to Cincinnati for no good reason.
It's nice.
I don't think. I mean, obviously not Dallas. Oh, Houston lost the, what, Oilers?
No, Dallas would not be one. No. Houston lost the Oilers.
New Orleans
In fact,
gained,
the Rockets moved there.
New Orleans gained the Pelicans.
Mm-hmm. That takes care of them.
Can't be Atlanta, I don't. Well.
Yeah, the Braves moved there.
Oh, it's not the Arizona because the Cardinals moved there from St. Louis.
Mm-hmm.
Denver.
Now, Denver's a good one.
Yeah, they got the Rockies expansion style. I don't believe the Broncos have been anywhere else. Avalanche.
They moved there from Quebec.
Oh, they did. The Nordiques.
Yes, the Nordiques. Oh.
What's the Avalanche's Rhyner nickname? Rock?
Snowball. That's what it is. I haven't whipped those out in a long time.
You need
time.
To freshen those up because I heard you drop one in a replay, and I'm like, I missed it.
Was it Lightning? He called them the Ning?
Yes.
Yeah, they're Ning.
But I think even people in Tampa call them the Ning, too. But Mike's NHL team nicknames is one of my favorites.
I'm just imitating the halcyon days of ESPN when Olbermann would do stuff like that.
Really?
And Dan Patrick. Yeah.
I did always love that.
I did, too.
So Denver does not count. Okay.
They come close.
Yeah, but no. San Diego clearly doesn't.
Mm-hmm.
L.A., no chance.
Mm-hmm.
San Francisco, no, they got baseball.
Mm-hmm. And the Warriors moved there.
Yeah. It's not Seattle. They lost the... Supersonics to OKC. Portland.
That counts.
That counts.
They're
right?
One.
Because they only.
But it's a one-team town.
Yep. But hey, we'll take that. Well, yep. Okay, then Green Bay. Well, you did ask for a large.
Another one-team town, but they split games with. Or they used to split games with Milwaukee.
Milwaukee?
Yeah.
How many are there? Do you know?
I don't know. I've never really been able. I've never had the. The mental initiative to really sit down and tally this up, but you know it's a fun late night reindeer game to play, and it usually makes me fall asleep, which is a good thing. Probably the best thing about it.
Is that one of your fall
asleep
tricks?
Good way to start the show.
Yes, what it takes to make Mike fall asleep.
I got 4 more hours, Shoopy.
Don't worry, Shoopy. I'm not going anywhere.
I know.
Look who's here.
Whoa! It's it.
So AO will probably address this. There is a wreck northbound on the tollway, really just after our exit to get here. So
you missed it?
Oh,
you were stuck in it?
I was stuck in it. So I apologize, guys. I got here as fast as I could, but there was a wreck northbound on the tollway, probably around Royal, right after 635.
Look at the traffic in her. She can't not deliver it eloquently.
My roots.
I like people who stick to their roots like that.
Yeah. Double duty for the always lovely Krystina Ray, who was at Pluckers with Ben and Skin.
It was really fun. Rhyner showed up.
I heard that. I was
Julie
listening.
Julie Kavanaugh.
I felt like a nerd
it
sitting at
blast.
My desk typing notes into a laptop when I should have been there having fun with y'all.
Well, you heard that you got a pass, right? You're Sirois, so.
Okay. I don't know what the hell that means.
He's shale.
Yeah. He can do whatever he wants.
Well, welcome, Krystina. She's going to kick it with us today. We're going to have a lot of fun today. And I'll tease ahead to 5 o'clock. That is haunted house chat.
Ooh.
And I know Mike said when I brought that up, what'd you say?
I don't know. What did I say?
He said, I like haunted houses.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I do.
But Krystina and I kicked off October in the best way possible. Went to Reindeer Manor. Went to a haunted house. And I rolled audio on us going through the entire haunted house. So
did you scream?
5 o'clock here on 97.1 The Freak.
You'll find out.
Somebody screamed. I think I've learned that loud laughter is how I try to replace my fear when I'm clearly scared. But, 5 o'clock. That'll be fun. We'll play some funny audio. We have a debut segment at 5:30. It's called Groobs Audio Dynamite.
Yes.
First time ever.
Oh, God.
Ready for this, Shoopy?
Am I ever ready for anything?
You killed that fact thing. I can't even remember what it's called.
Yeah, we were
now.
Just talking about that.
Yeah, I heard y'all talking about it. It was like, he did great, and I texted him immediately because I heard him do it.
Like, if I was a real professional, I would have double-checked if Skin or someone was ready to do it, but I panicked and was like, well,
no,
crap, I guess
good.
I got to do it.
Dude, you stepped into action.
Good.
That's
yeah.
what heroes do.
Yeah.
Gotta take care of our sponsors.
They walk
we
toward
love them.
The danger, not away from it, and that's what you did.
Thank you,
we also have at 6 o'clock the debut of Big Natural Tweets.
All right.
Okay, Grooves, if you're going to laugh at your own joke, you have to turn the damn mic
yeah,
on.
Yeah, turn
right?
on the microphone.
That's
shoot.
The trade-off. We agree to give you your own room. The mic stays on when Grooves is giggling. That's
all
why,
right, fair enough.
That's what we're here for.
That was pretty good.
Yeah, we didn't bring you in here to just go mic off on.
No.
Sorry.
That million-dollar laugh is why you're getting $1 million
yes,
per year.
Yes, the shoopy chuckle.
Totally worth it.
So Big Natural Tweets will be at 6 o'clock, and if you'd like to participate in that segment, at DownbeatDFW, you can submit your tweets. If you have a question for Mike Rhyner, for the always lovely, for myself, or for Tweet Grooves in there, fire away. We'll compile them and have a little fun answering them. Hypotheticals, jokes, whatever you got, man. We will knock it all out. Michael, T-shirt of the day. You are representing the Dallas Police Department since
yes, sir.
1881. It is a black tee. Our spreadsheets have been updated. Any story behind that tee?
I got that from the police. I went down there and did a podcast that they do with the great Joe King and his guys down there.
Just last couple years, you went and...
Earlier this year, I want to say.
Nice.
Yeah, I went down there and they invited me to come down and do their podcast with them. And I exchanged hot sports opinions on what's going on here in our fair burg and why. And it was great.
Yeah?
It was great. Really enjoyed hanging with those boys. And they gave me this nice T-shirt. Now, you're seeing this, but look here.
Yeah, the back of it.
Back. Okay, we have
look at that.
All the assorted badges.
All the
the divisions.
Yes, all the assorted branches and divisions of police.
Let's see. Shoopy, try to guess the branches and divisions of the Dallas Police Department. Christina, you can play, too.
Oh, God. Okay.
Hey, you know what? Reiner's wearing the damn shirt, but it's on his back, so you get to play,
see
too.
If you know it.
I don't. I'll tell you right now, I don't.
Come on.
Tax squad. They're in there somewhere.
They are in there somewhere. We have the gang unit.
Mm-hmm.
G unit.
Sounds cool.
G unit, like us. Narcotics.
Yes.
Vice squad.
Vice is in there.
CSI.
Oh, there is a Dallas Police crime scene.
Hey.
And they all have their own logos. The crime scene has the silhouette of downtown, the skyline, with what appears to be like a red sun on top of it. Vice unit? You ain't kidding. Oh, there's a martini in the Vice unit.
Cool.
Yes. We need that in here.
There's,
just that patch.
Oh, my God. It says Dallas Police. Sorry to be pushing you, Mike. I'm trying to get the mic.
Y'all are both so excited about it. I know.
I'm rolling it around. There you go. Thank you. There you go. Just turn a little. Just flip me over here.
Hold on.
The Dallas Police Vice Unit has a pair of dice, a martini glass, and a high-heeled red stiletto.
See, they make it sound so cool.
Yeah.
What are they doing?
Yeah. We love all those things.
Right.
I love all three of those. The mounted unit.
Is there, yeah.
What?
No comment.
What does that mean?
Is there a canine unit on there?
Absolutely. Anywhere? Canine squad.
Hell yeah.
Big unit?
Sir.
Yes. There's a silhouette of Randy Johnson's hair.
Perfect.
Fluttering. There's a silhouette of a bird exploding in a baseball. We have the love field unit, because we're going to shout them all out, because they're listening. They're probably popping their sirens. We do have SWAT, helicopter unit, mounted unit, bicycle patrol, motorcycle, explosive ordnance squad.
That's super badass.
That's cool. Oh, my God. Underwater team.
Yeah. How
about Shell.
That? Oh, right. That's me.
All these Christmas ideas coming.
The Trinity River Navy needs to hire the DPD underwater team.
All right, if you're DPD driving around, honk your horn and scare the hell out of everybody if you're listening to The Freak.
Pull somebody over and tell them they should be, and reach in there and turn their radio on The Freak.
Big shout out to 5-0, and if we may invoke the words which broke up the morning get-together every week on Hill Street Blues. Let's be careful out there.
Rule number six.
That's
Let's
it.
Be careful out there. When was the last time you got pulled over by Dallas's finest?
It's been a long time.
Really?
I'm a good boy now.
Are you?
Yeah.
Were you a bad boy back in the day?
Worse than now.
A little heel to the steel?
Yeah, a little bit.
Leadfoot Rhyner?
Mm-hmm, a little bit. I wasn't as conscientious of things as I am now.
But then they pull you over and you open your wallet and all these Sim Fighters passes accidentally fall right toward the cop.
Yeah. Oops, how did those get here?
You can pick those up. I don't know how many there are.
I really don't feel like getting out, officer. Just keep those.
Those are for you. Yeah. Doing a hell of a job this afternoon.
Yeah, you're doing good work. You're doing the Lord's work out here today.
You know what? You'd be surprised to hear. I am, with how I look, that I am on a streak of four straight get pulled over, only get a warnings. Thank you.
Wow.
It's impressive.
Thank you. Wait. Magic wink.
Yes, exactly. You're winking at them, and they're just like, oh, I'm sorry.
They just get glassy-eyed. And
I forgot why I'm here.
I will return to my car.
That's shale magic.
Yeah. I'll tell you what, the best one, real quick. My brother, Kat, this is 15 years ago, right when I got to Dallas. I was on Greenville Avenue going south, right by where that Kroger is and the Dr. Pepper sign, like approaching Mockingbird.
Yeah.
And there's that bridge that you go over with the electrical area, like right to the left.
Matilda Bridge?
I do not know.
Matilda, yeah.
Is it? And Cash had just got like a Nissan Z, I think. This is 20 years ago.
So Cash.
And he let me drive it. First time I ever drove it, I was hauling balls to go either pick up food or something. And I go over that bridge, and there's a cop standing in the street, basically just waving me in. I'm like, all right. I'm like, dude, he let me borrow his car for a two-mile drive, and I get yanked. And I pull right into that Kroger parking lot. And I'm super friendly with everyone, but certainly in this scenario. And it made him, I guess, be friendly. He goes, tell you what, I'll give you a chance. If you can guess the exact speed you are going, the exact speed that's on my radar right now, I will let you off. And I'm like, and he had the radar like turned around to his chest, you know? I think it was a 35-mile-an-hour speed limit. And I don't know why, but the great Miami Dolphin linebacker Brian Cox popped into my head. He was number 51. And I go, 51! And he just stares at me, and he just turns the radar gun around. It says 51 on it. He goes,
whoa.
Have a nice day.
That's amazing.
And I'm like, oh! I was trying to, like, high-five him, and he loved it.
Yeah,
like,
cool guy.
He was like, you're the only third person that's ever actually got off on this game. I'm like, oh, yes!
You played the reindeer game and won.
I did! I didn't win the city game that you presented to me, but I did that. And that set off. That was the first of, I think, four in a row. Super kill him with kindness. And they've let me off with warnings.
My only bad interaction with them is the night that I got hauled in for buying, possessing, and receiving stolen goods in Bergen County, New Jersey.
What? Is this next segment?
Yeah, coming up next, Mike Rhyner will tell us about buying, possessing, and securing stolen goods and
receiving, not securing.
And in somewhere in New Jersey. That will be next in the Silver Alert featuring Mike Rhyner.
The divorce?
Yes.
Tia Mowry.
Of what, Mr. Mister?
She was Mister Sister.
His interest will plummet when he finds out it's not Mr. Mister, and it is Sister Sister.
Okay, what is that?
It's a show.
Oh, it is?
Yeah, it was a show I watched growing up.
Yeah, two twin sisters, and they got into capers and adventures and...
I love
had
campers.
Trouble at school or whatever else they did.
I would love to watch Mr.
But
Mister, though.
But yeah, but now she's single, so I'm going to find her.
It's your time, Shoops.
She she's will gorgeous. Be mine.
Yeah. It is
just
your time.
Swoop on in there, Shoopy.
I'll encourage you to listen to 4:30. I'm talking Fringe Sport Fracas. Three sports, all with significant issues going on with them right now, Michael. One of them is Irish dancing, one is chess, and one is fishing. There's been cheating involved in all three of those sports. One of them, the cheating perhaps involved a butt plug.
What?
Whoa.
Which of those three sports do you think?
Fishing.
There's no good or bad. There's no good or bad guess to that question, so.
No, there's really not, but I'll just say fishing, just for the heck of it.
I don't hate that guess at all. You'll find out at 4:30 in Sport Report. And then, as always, 5 o'clock on the nose, it's time for Fun Drive, and we will have fun while you drive. But right now, we need to hear a quick story before we get into the Silver Alert, because it's me, Mike Sirois, it's Krystina Ray, and we have the bad boy of Bergen County joining us right now, who teased us with, what was your tease?
The one time that I have had an unpleasant interaction with police was a time in 1971. I was 21 years old. It was a weeknight. I was driving around in a 58 Chevy, which probably got about I don't know, 500 to 1,000 feet for every quart of oil it leaked.
500 to 1,000 feet.
And it was a 3-speed on the column.
Mm-hmm.
Nice, huh?
Yeah.
Nice ride. Look, I'm a mess, okay?
It's okay.
And, yes, I'd been out one night, and it was not terribly late. It's probably about 10:30 or 11. I was going to college at El Centro then and everything, trying to get some sort of direction and focus to my scene,
mm-hmm.
of which I had absolutely none. And all of a sudden, I'm driving down the road, and I might have been a little high at the time. But fortunately, I wasn't holding anything, because this would have been much, much worse, especially when you consider the time. Back then, if you were toting around any amount of pot, they weren't fronting no games back then. But all of a sudden, the red lights appear in the car, and I pull over.
Mm-hmm.
And the guy comes up and says, let me see your driver's license. They didn't require proof of insurance or anything like that back then, so I just gave him the driver's license. And he said, I said, what did I do here exactly, sir? I was very, very polite, very nice. He said, you're going 5 miles over the speed limit.
Okay.
And I thought, well, okay, this seems a little bit pissant, but whatever.
Yeah.
And he said, I'll be right back. And so I sit there. And it took him an extraordinarily long time to do whatever he had to do, you know. Like, I'd gotten tickets before. I kind of knew the drill a little bit. And it took him a long time, and then he comes up in a very defensive posture, says, get out of the car. I said, okay. And I did. He says, turn around, put your hands on the roof.
Whoa.
And I'm like, sir, what did I do here exactly? And he just didn't say anything. He frisked me and everything. And then he said, let me see you put your hands behind your back. And he cuffed me. And I said, he said, you're under arrest. I said, for what? He said, buying, possessing, and receiving stolen goods in Bergen County, New Jersey. And I told him, sir, I've never been to New Jersey. And he would have none of that. And he took me down to the city jail and threw me in there. They gave me one phone call, and I called my old man and told him what had happened. He was already crashed by then,
mm-hmm.
probably marginally sober, I would say.
Was he here?
Like in
your dad?
Yeah.
Okay.
Like in Dallas?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, he was here. And I told him what had happened and what I'd been arrested for, and he said, have you ever been to New Jersey? I said, no. You know I haven't been to New Jersey. And so he said, all right, just do what they say. Do what they say. We'll fix this tomorrow. And so I spent the night in jail.
The Gray Bar Hotel.
Yes, in the Gray Bar Hotel. And the next day, my old man got his lawyer and came down and got me out. Mm-hmm. And as things turned out.
Was that the Frankel's great-grandfather?
I believe this. Yeah, that was Homer Frankel, I believe.
Homer.
Yeah, we're Franklin Frankel when I need it.
Yeah, what the hell?
The hell, man?
Homer.
Come on, you guys need to learn how to rewind the clock or something.
You know, Homer Frankel is our first character.
And he came down there and got me and everything, and the situation proceeded. Then a couple days after that, he called me up and said, you're off the hook. And I said, oh, I am? How come? He said, this was a false arrest. Or a bad arrest. And I said, why? He said, you know, I'm really not sure. But the guy, they figured out the guy was definitely not you. And the guy's name was Mario Hernandez Ramirez or something
like
that.
Not even close.
No, not even close. He had the same initials as me.
Oh, my God.
But that's it.
So mistaken identity?
Yes, we're talking mistaken identity here.
What was his name again?
Mario Hernandez Ramirez. I'm going to get a tattoo of that.
How do you should.
So the how guy long caused you to get arrested, you'd remember his name, too.
Yeah, probably so. How long were you in prison or in jail?
That probably happened about 11 at night. And by, I don't know, 8:30 the next day, I was out of there. I made my first class at El Centro.
You did?
Yeah.
Nice.
Did you go straight to class after that?
Pretty much. Let me tell you, though, that city jail ain't fronting no games in there.
No?
No. Not back then, anyway. I don't have any idea what it's like now, but back then, if they took you down to the city jail, then you probably better stay loose in there, because you're probably going to come into contact with some rather unusual characters.
I don't want to stay loose in jail.
Okay. You see her head
whip. We all thought it.
We all see it. She has blue hair.
I've never been to jail. I wouldn't last a second. No, I'd be terrified.
No, you're a hard-ass bee.
I'm sure.
Can you get in there?
Yeah.
I spent 2 nights in jail.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll let's just keep talking jail for a minute.
Okay.
You know, because I know you have a ton on the Silver Alert that we wanted to talk about, and I don't want to rush that. So we'll save that for Monday or Tuesday.
Okay.
I'll tell the story someday in the future about the night I spent in Mexican prison, which is a pretty funny story. But I'll tell you about my only domestic evening I spent in jail. I was in Flagstaff, Arizona. I was in college, and I had 4 roommates, and we were weed heads.
Pot heads.
Were. Pretty big party house.
Were. Yeah. I mean, not even like anything insane. College kids with weed everywhere and bongs next to every couch and pipes and ashtrays. I mean, kind of standard stoner fare. Nothing
sure.
All that nefarious.
Sure.
But
that's my house right now.
We could find a bong in Shoopy's house. I would love to find it.
Someone Photoshop it onto Mike's awesome chair.
Yeah.
Sit next to it. And we had a couple dogs, and we had a neighbor across the way that hated the dogs. So whenever they would bark, he would be a little tender nuts about it.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess the dog was barking, and I think the neighbor across the way called the police. And then we had the front door open, which I guess was our bad mistake, because if the front door is open in Arizona, can they just enter? I don't know the law. Well, they also could smell weed wafting out of the house and visible paraphernalia, I would imagine. But the truth is, I was upstairs in bed. I think one of my roommates was there smoking and watching, you know, Bad Boys.
Bad Boys.
Something weird. So I was awoken to a Arizona Flagstaff police officer shaking me, waking me up. And he, you know, I didn't know what was going on, but he essentially said, "You're under arrest for possession of marijuana." I'm like,
"Were you nude?"
I was not nude.
What?
No, fair question. Fair,
yeah, it is a fair question.
It is. I just wasn't thinking that.
Been a while since we've heard that question.
That was a front of mind for him. His outfit. I believe I had.
Yeah, I've been looking to work it in all week.
Were you nude?
I believe I had boxer shorts on. But there was a pipe, weed pipe, sitting somewhere in my room, so I guess I was thrown into this thing, and they let me put some clothes on, and I think I did get handcuffed, and great, police car, you know, from being sound asleep, peacefully, dreaming about dinosaurs, to straight to the Flagstaff Police Department. And I will say, I had trouble sleeping at the time, so I would always take, like, NyQuil or a sleep aid, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So I had taken one shortly before I went to sleep. So I get to the Flagstaff Police Department, and you get nude then. Yeah. Including open sesame.
Ooh, yes. They got to search you?
That's real. I didn't know this was real. Yeah.
Weird. Penetration, however slight?
No, I don't recall. I don't think of any.
Okay.
I don't think the gloved hand
if you did permeated that, anything. Would they immediately just turn away? Like, you know what? If you have something in there, you're
like
good.
A human skunk. That's your natural defense mechanism.
Yeah. You know what? If it didn't come out there.
That's true.
So then they put me in the temporary drunk tank, basically. And again, I'm like groggy from NyQuil. I'm probably a little stoned.
Yeah,
I'm like,
I had a little swim through that, too, the drunk tank.
Did you? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And this was probably 2 a.m., so I get in there, and it's full of drunks, many of which were, in this particular evening, Native Americans, because Flagstaff is right on the border of the Navajo tribe in northern Arizona,
mm-hmm.
So a lot of natives in our area, and there was just only 2 cots left available. There's probably 20 people, most of them passed out, some of them standing around. 2 cots were available, so I went and laid down in one of the available cots, and the only remaining cot was right next to the one metallic toilet that was in here for all the drunk drunk tank people to use. And shortly after I went in, my friend, we'll call him Mark, was ushered into the drunk tank, and he's had to lay down in the one remaining cot, which happened to be about 18 inches from the bowl of the prison toilet. And he sat, it was directly across from me, so he sat, arms crossed, kind of leaning against the wall, just staring at me, shaking his head, as we're mad at our third roommate, the guy wasn't even there, who probably left the door open. And I leaned back, and I realized, this sucks, but I'm spending the night in jail, and I think I'm fairly happy that I took that NyQuil, because I'm about to nod off and call it a night, and we'll see how these chips fall in the morning and figure it all out. But the final memory I have in the Flagstaff Police Department was looking over at my friend Mark, and he's shaking his head, and a very large, 350-plus pound Native American man walks over to that metallic toilet, and he drops trowel and unleashes absolute hell. Groove has been waiting for this moment.
Yeah.
All of this... Let the big finish.
One shining moment.
All of this about 3 feet away from my friend Mark's face.
Oh, my God.
As he's just shaking his head, and I close my eyes to drift off to sleep.
How did he fare with all that, your friend?
I mean, you know, so long ago, that the only real image I have is his anger and sadness as that large gentleman did his business right next to him. We're fine with that.
So what are you? Are you more angry?
I'm nothing.
About, but I mean, just put yourself in his place.
Him?
In that situation.
I think the side part of the story was that we had told our third roommate not to leave the door open, something like that. Put your pipe away. Like, let's not just be idiots here. So I think he and I were both asleep, and we're the ones that got dinged for this. So we were probably mad at our third roommate. He was. And then in some trouble. But so much so that we had to get a lawyer, and then you get out of jail and all this stuff. And I think at that time, marijuana possession in Arizona was still like a felony.
So, it certainly was here.
Yeah. I mean, I have a pipe and a couple tiny bags of weed. It was noted as a felony, and then it had to be worked down to be a misdemeanor. And I don't want to use specifics, but even when I moved to Dallas, I was trying to get into an apartment, which I mentioned recently on the show, and they... good for them, I think, have a policy of no felons are going to move in here, which I tend to be like, all right. But there was like a red alert of I may have trouble moving in there. And I'm like, wait, everybody chill.
Yeah.
So I had to dig up the name of the lawyers and find the paperwork that proved that it was knocked down from a felony to a misdemeanor. And I was allowed to move into the apartment here in Dallas.
So how
you
long?
You still have that?
Have what?
The paperwork. With a lawyer's
name. I think it was faxed to like the apartment house or something. I don't know if I ever even acquired it personally.
I don't know. I think I'd want that for a souvenir.
Yeah, put it up in the studio.
Glorious night. Yeah, I need crap to hang on the walls in here, right?
It's a reminder of what you can do. how long were you in jail for? Was it just that night?
Same as him. The next morning is all I remember.
That's good.
And I slept most of it.
Yeah.
Boy, I didn't.
Were you up the whole time?
Of course.
That's why the sleep aid was fortuitous, because I probably would have been up. And I think my friend Mark, when I finally did wake up, he was still in the exact same cross-armed position, shaking his head as probably another half dozen fellas had gone and had their moment in the sun right next to him. Okay.
He'll never sleep.
He loves that.
That
he loves it.
He just loves
Look,
that.
You gave me an opportunity, and I'm going to take
that
it.
That was as the you ultimate. Should. I heard one misfire, a weird one during their show today during Ben and Sia, and I'm like, what?
Yeah, that'll happen.
I didn't know if it was a misfire. You just...
I totally missed it. Do you remember it?
Pent up Shoopy had to get
I don't know.
Off.
I can't remember a full-on misfire.
Well,
but
I may have not understood
It might not
the
have
reference.
Been funny, but...
right.
That's exactly. Going
to
happen.
Are Ben and Skin not giving you room to do your thing, Shoopy?
No, yeah. They've been awesome. I think they're just out on remote, so I don't know if it's... I'm guessing it's not easy to hear drops and stuff out
it's
there.
It's harder to hear audio when you're on a remote, which is why we didn't do the Today game
right.
today. So they probably just didn't hear
yeah.
it.
Yeah, not their fault.
You know, one more thing I learned about Mike Rhyner today in the pre-show meeting? He pulled this move, and it's one of the coolest things ever. And I don't know what his phone... said when it rang, but his phone rang, and I hear him basically maybe mutter an OS or what is this, And then he clicks on accept and he just went, speak.
Yes.
Have you heard this before?
I have. I was like, he's never done it to me, but I've definitely heard that.
I was like, oh. And I'm like, is that somebody knows? Is that a, you know, political robocall? Like, is that spam risk? I don't know what the levels are, but.
That's a Tony Soprano move there.
And you regularly pull that?
To people I don't know, yeah.
So was it a mysterious number or what did it say?
It was a number I didn't know.
Okay. Speak.
That's amazing.
Man, I haven't thought about Shoopy doing that in forever.
I never heard that lie. That was bad A. Is everything
okay? I don't know you. That's what you get.
Speak. Is everything okay on the call?
They hung up.
Hell yeah.
I would too after that.
Works
Sorry.
Every dang time.
Yep. Sorry, that's the whole idea.
All right, we're going to get into fun stuff. I have some sport talk for 4:30, which I think everyone will find interesting.
You got what?
Sport talk.
Wait a minute. We're not a sports station, man.
Well, it's mostly about it's mostly about fishing and chess. And we are whatever we want to be, aren't we, Michael?
We are.
But whatever coming up next, there's an epidemic of people that work at the station talking about dinosaurs, and they don't shut up. So I have a segment called, Apparently These People All Love Dinosaurs. So we'll do that with the always lovely Krystina Ray as your host in just a moment. Can I ask a question about our last segment?
Sure.
When you told the whole Bergen County story, I was assuming you were driving through Bergen County, New Jersey.
Mm-hmm.
Were you?
No.
Okay, this was all in Dallas.
Yes.
Was I the only one on that?
No, I agree. I thought the same thing.
But maybe I should have made myself clear. I'm sorry.
But that makes it even weirder that guy arrested you.
Yeah.
That you didn't.
I know.
And
I know.
Mario Hernandez Ramirez was a denizen of Bergen County, New Jersey?
Presumably.
Ah. Because you said you made it to El Centro the next day, and I'm like, I am confused by a big piece of this. I had Bergen County map.
God, I'm sorry.
No, you're fine.
Nah, if you're confused, probably everybody else was, too.
And that's why I asked if your dad was here in town when you called him.
Yeah.
And I was trying to get to the question of why the hell were you in Bergen County, New Jersey?
And here I'm thinking, why is he asking me that?
And why's your car, this crappy car that only go 500 feet per quart of oil?
All the way in New Jersey.
How do you make it to New Jersey?
Did you see Ben Coker's tweet, by the way?
Yeah, Mike, you see this one?
Yeah, I did.
I did.
My tattoo.
With your forearm tattoo that says Mario Hernandez Ramirez and Austin Bell. I like Photoshops are happening.
It's
We're doing
great.
It, guys.
Fun.
Austin Bell has your chair with a bong shaped like a penis next to it.
That's unfortunate.
Excellent.
That is not.
Excellent.
Excellent. Well, I love it. I love it all.
I love it too.
We're going to do a segment at 6 o'clock called Big Natural Tweets, where you can tweet us at DownbeatDFW, and we'll select which ones we want to read and answer and talk about, and we're going to do it all together, and that'll be at 6 o'clock. But I'm going to start with a Big Natural Tweet that will kick off this segment, because White Squirrel Records asked us simply, what is everyone's favorite dinosaur?
All right.
And that brings us to the always lovely Krystina Ray, who I think is going to walk us through a segment about dinosaurs, which... Between you, Krystina, you, Michael, and Jeff Cavanaugh on The Morning Show, each of our three shows here on the Freak have a dinosaur representative on them.
Yeah, we all love dinosaurs, which is kind of cool. Super nerdy. But I do want to know why Mike Rhyner loves dinosaurs so much. I'll tell you why I do after him. Go ahead.
Something I got infatuated with as a kid. Mm-hmm. I had a book with pictures of all the notable dinosaurs in there. And I don't know, I was just drawn into their whole scene and everything. And I've been a big fan of dinosaurs for my entire life and a big camp follower of dinosaurs. And when Jurassic Park came out, oh man, I was all about it. Still love that film.
Opening night?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, I agree. So they were talking about favorite movies on the Ben and Skin Show today, and that was the first one that popped in my mind. Because I think it still holds up.
I do, too.
And Skin's never seen it. I'm trying to get him to see
That's
it.
That's weird.
Isn't it weird?
Why never has he never seen that?
I don't know.
He and gives no so reason for this?
No.
I mean, okay. He's sort of a pop culture...
Film nerd, yeah.
Film nerd.
He's a pop culture expert.
But this song right here, it's so pretty. I love it. But like you,
oh,
so...
it puts me in that place.
I know.
Is this John Williams...
Yes.
I think it is.
It is.
He's like the Dr. James Andrews of big movie songs.
What?
I couldn't think of the right way to say it.
I was going
to
let you keep
going. But it's like the only guy you think of always. It's John Williams. And if you think of arthroscopic surgery, you think of Dr. James Andrews.
All right.
So I guess when the elbow of a film music song needs repair, they call him.
Yeah, if the violinist can't get her done anymore. This is a beautiful song.
Yes.
And I'm not anti-dinosaur or anti-Jurassic Park, although I am pretty anti the last few Jurassic.
I haven't watched the last one, the most recent one.
I haven't either, but the one before
that. I like them all.
Really?
Like them all.
So you've seen the newest one?
Yeah.
And it was good. It held up?
Liked it.
With all the old characters returning and everything?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Maybe I should see it.
That Goldblum and company is the only draw I would have toward this new one. And I do like the first one. But the last one I saw, which is two before the most recent, I think, was Cheese Dong.
Yeah.
I hated it.
Like you, Mike, I grew up just loving them. My parents got me like a whole thesaurus of dinosaurs. I used to know all of them. That's how nerdy I was. I wanted to be a paleontologist for a little bit until I was told that you have to work in a museum for most of that time.
Mm-hmm.
And until you found Led Zeppelin.
And yes, exactly. And realized, oh, wait, there's a lot cooler things I can do with my life. But also, before Jurassic Park, I watched The Land Before Time, showing my age here. The Land Before Time, there's another movie called We're Back, which was these big dinosaurs. And I just loved them. And Jurassic Park is still one of my favorite movies to this day. So that's
why. Wasn't We're Back, bitches?
No, just We're Back. It was a kids' movie.
All right.
They might have done a remake for adults called We're Back, Bitches.
So, Michael, you just had the book, and that's how it all started for you.
That's how it all started for me.
And
from that point on, I read anything I could find about dinosaurs, which was no easy feat back then. But I would go to the library, and whenever I saw a book on dinosaurs or baseball, I would check both of them out. And I have been a camp follower all my life.
So your favorite dinosaur, Mike?
I like them all. But if I had to pick out one, I probably would lean pretty heavily toward the Allosaurus.
All right.
Now, I know the chalk says T-Rex, and the T-Rex is a badass. If we're going on sheer badassery, he's probably the play for anybody. But I've always been partial to Allosaurus. He's more in the mid-sized dinosaur range. But like T-Rex, he's got wicked bitchin' teeth.
Yes, he does.
And he's not quite as big, which probably makes him a little bit more maneuverable. And I'll bet he's faster and able to track down prey a little bit easier than T-Rex is. And I've always felt that if I were to run into an actual dinosaur in the wild, the Allosaurus would be a far more clear and present threat than the T-Rex. I think I might stand a chance of doing something to outmaneuver the T-Rex, but I wouldn't the Allosaurus.
Do you think zigzag running would be one of your techniques?
Because
that's what, alligator, do the zigzag.
Right, I would try that, for sure. And I think the Allosaurus could handle that.
See, I'm looking up, because Kavanaugh is on a podium of Tyrannosaurus Rex being overrated.
Yeah, he says it sucks, He didn't move that fast, and he has little tiny arms, so he couldn't really do much.
I'm just looking
at
it.
Good points.
King of the tyrant lizards. And it says, a bite force three times that of the great white shark, making it the strongest bite force of any land animal that has ever lived.
This is the T-Rex we're talking about?
Yes.
Yeah, he's a badass, no doubt about it.
Do you think it's too overhyped, though, the T-Rex?
It's probably more a matter of sheer preference for me.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like rating offensive linemen. So some people just like big.
Yeah.
If they're big, then you figure you can put up with whatever deficiencies there may be.
Mm-hmm.
I prefer the smaller, more agile offensive linemen. So that puts me in the Allosaurus range, I think.
All right, the Allosaurus is spoken for. Christina?
Mine is the plesiosaur.
Mike, do you know the plesiosaur?
Not quite as familiar with the plesiosaur.
I feel like that's an underwater, isn't it?
It is underwater, technically the Loch Ness monster is a plesiosaur.
Oh, okay.
But could it kill you and cook you?
It absolutely could.
I don't know, man. I
think no doubt.
Only the giant squid can do that.
Let's get Pud on the phone and find out if The plesiosaurus also. Why the plesiosaurus? Did the plesiosaurus appear in any of the Jurassic Park movies?
You know what? It didn't. And I think the whole Loch Ness thing, seriously, I'm a super nerd. You have no idea.
It's okay.
I was infatuated with that as well.
You
got
to be nerdy to be here.
I know. And then also there's a Pokemon that was my favorite. It was a Lapras, and it was technically a plesiosaurus.
What was the water dinosaur in the first Chris Pratt Jurassic Park one? Remember when they're at the water park, and then they dangle
a
great white shark
up.
Or a killer whale, and then it jumps up? That was in like the first trailer, and I'm like, okay, that's badass.
I believe Kronosaurus.
Kronosaurus?
Yeah, that's it.
That trailer was popular, I think, right about when I got Simon, my little puppy dog.
Yeah.
And he was so tiny, and I got out of the shower once, and I was naked and in front of the mirror, and he ran between my legs, and he tried to jump up between my legs like the water dinosaur, and he barely just missed it.
Why would you tell that story?
I don't know, but I'm marking it.
Are you looking at a picture of the plesio?
I am. Oh, they look hardcore, dude.
They're awesome.
Yeah, he's fearsome.
Yeah. But any of the water dinosaurs are terrifying.
They are.
And there's no telling what else is out there, you know? We have no idea.
That sounds like a Rhyner quote.
That's right. Because everything is going on out there a lot more than we think it is.
Most dinosaurs were on land,
but it's been proven.
Most on land?
On land?
I mean, I guess I don't know. Because I just looked up. There's 700 different... That's part of the thing with dinosaurs. There's too many.
What?
There's too many dinosaurs. That's why I'm not anti, again, but I just, there's too many.
There are a lot of different variations and different species and this and that, for sure.
It gets confusing.
There was a lot of dinosaur inbreeding, I think.
Yeah, probably so.
A T-Rex, like, running funny.
Okay, what?
Because it's inbred, I don't know.
I definitely had a book of dinosaurs as well, just like anyone. And I liked it, fine, but I just never had an obsession with it like you two and Kavanaugh apparently did.
Yeah, I'm not sure why. It just stuck with me. It's like, oh, these are cool. I want to learn more about them.
Man, I'd give anything if I still had mine.
We could find you a book on dinosaurs.
But I want the one I had.
The exact one or a copy?
Yeah, the exact one.
Well, I can't help you with that.
Or a copy of it, but I don't know the title of it or anything. Besides, it was probably published in the early 40s. So.
And I'm sure it was a picture book.
It was.
Here, dinosaur buck. I'll check.
Okay.
I bet we'll find it. Just like that article yesterday where you're like, I can't find it. We found it.
Immediately.
That was impressive.
Man, that was impressive.
While you're looking that up, just a few days ago, it's been discovered more about the asteroid that killed the dinosaurs.
Okay.
So this happened 66 million years ago. There was a city-sized asteroid, they said, 8.7 miles wide that hit the Earth. Do we know how wide Dallas is?
When I'm interested again.
Right, when it says city-sized asteroid, so 8.7 miles.
Oh, do you not know the answer, though?
No, I don't.
Dallas or the Metroplex? See, that's always the game.
I mean, whichever is 8.7 miles, so we can
Where does Dallas end?
I mean, that's also a good question. How wide is Dallas? Where does Dallas end and how wide?
Yeah, I don't know how
Dallas
to even search that as easy as it is. Because Dallas city limits are different than Dallas County?
Yeah, besides, you got all the suburbs. Do they count?
I don't know. Where was this?
We're going to let Garland into this discussion.
Uh-oh. Taking a shot at Christina's former...
I used to live there.
...place of residence.
Oh, I'm sorry, Christina.
It's okay. I moved, so you can do it.
All right, I'll look at the south side. We're going to let Duncanville in on this.
Too many curbside toilets in Garland for me. I had to leave.
So what was the fun fact? What'd you say?
Oh, 8.7 miles wide is how big this asteroid was that hit Earth.
Do we know where it hit?
There's more to it, but yeah. Mexico's Yucatan Peninsula.
Nice.
Not far.
Not far at all.
No. But
I felt it here.
Yeah. On top of this asteroid hitting, it caused a huge tsunami that just went through the entire globe.
Oh, yeah.
So this asteroid destroyed 75% of all living things immediately.
Immediately.
Because it caused that tsunami. It caused dust to fill the air. There was like raining, flaming debris everywhere that caught fire. Actually, really scary.
Why don't we start moistening the earth?
Moistening the earth.
So the dust doesn't cover the sun and kill us all. Like, this asteroid thing's going to happen. I know they sent the DART up there and they practiced how to destroy it. But on a long enough time spectrum, an asteroid is going to hit us and kill 75% of the earth immediately. And then the dust is what's going to get the rest of us.
But how do you propose we do this?
I don't know, pumps?
Just everybody run sprinklers 24 hours a day?
Yeah.
We start everyone running our sprinklers. Everyone get water guns. Let's go.
We get a bunch of pumps and hoses in the ocean, and we start getting to work.
So they compared the
trying
tsunami.
To save the planet.
Yeah, I appreciate it. It's a weird move, but at least you're trying.
Thank you.
Do you know the...
Support.
Indian...
Nice effort, little buddy.
The Indian Ocean tsunami back in 2004, do you guys remember this?
Oh, alarm? Yeah.
So it killed 230,000 people?
Dude, the tsunami is terrifying. Well, the people of tsunami.
This one that killed the dinosaurs was 30,000 times more energetic than that one.
Oh my God, really?
Yeah. It's a recent study they discovered.
By studying, comprehend that.
I know. By studying ocean sedentary or whatever it's called. Yep.
That. So that's proven? That's because I always thought it was a hypothesis or just assumed. I mean, something had to wipe out the dinosaurs. An asteroid seems to be the, I guess, most logical thing. And what you said does make sense. But, man, where's the giant hole in Yucatan? Is it in the ocean?
It's in the ocean. And we just had this argument not too long ago. And didn't that cause the Pangea thing to separate, all the continents to separate? Is that a stupid question?
I don't know. Mike read the book.
I thought that's what caused it. They were all together, and that's why all the dinosaurs are everywhere.
Yeah, spread about.
I don't remember that part.
Okay. Well, now we're going to...
I cannot say with any definitive idea.
Okay. Now we're going to go to another dinosaur, but a more friendly one, Barney.
Oh.
You guys are too old for Barney. Y'all didn't watch that,
no,
right?
No, no,
no.
No? Well, I mean, I didn't watch it, but my young daughter sure did.
So you were around for your share of Barney?
Oh, yes.
So I wasn't aware of the Dallas ties with
Barney. The dinosaur sensation.
Yeah, I had no idea.
I believe they filmed it in Las Colinas, maybe?
It's an Allen-based production company.
I've been to a studio for some TV stuff, and I thought it was the one in Las Colinas where they still have, like, purple foot... marks, Barney
really?
Foot marks, like down like the main hallway as a memento of it being where Barney was filmed.
That's pretty cool.
I think so.
Dallas school teacher Cheryl Leach is the person who created Barney because, like us, Mike, her son loved dinosaurs. And she was like, you know what, to keep him entertained and other kids entertained, let's make a friendly dinosaur.
See? You can dismiss the dinosaur all you want.
I don't feel like I'm dismissing it. I apologize.
No, I'm not talking to you. I'm talking to them out there.
But?
You can dismiss the dinosaur all you want, but look at Cheryl Leach. She did not.
No, she didn't. And she's probably like a billionaire now
because
of it.
She's probably very wealthy on account of it.
Well, let me look up Barney's net worth.
Okay. There's a documentary coming out on the dark side of Barney, though. It's going to be on Peacock, a two-part series.
I don't know if I want to see that.
I know, but apparently the guy who's playing Barney received death threats. And they're going to do a deep dive into why and all the things behind it. The first one will be October 12th, and the first episode's called I Love You, You Hate Me.
Oh, this is Netflix, you say?
No, Peacock.
Peacock.
Which I don't think I have Peacock.
This sort of reminds me of the fine 2002 comedy thriller Death to Smoochie. Am I the only one that's seen that?
It sounds familiar, but yes, no, I haven't seen it.
And I remember, granted, this was probably the day before I got arrested for all that weed in Arizona I told you about, because I remember laughing my ass off to this movie, and Rotten Tomatoes apparently doesn't agree. But we had Robin Williams, Danny DeVito, Edward Norton.
Okay. Wow, I'm ashamed of myself.
John Stewart was in this thing.
I should have seen this.
Like, I thought it was pretty funny, and I did pass it on to a friend of mine that I worked at Outback Steakhouse with, and he and his girlfriend watched it, and the next day they came in and said, that's the worst movie we have ever seen in our whole lives. And that rattled me, because I respected that
man. You loved it?
Yes.
All right.
And you know who that guy was? As odd as it is?
Cash?
No, the brother of NFL quarterbacking legend Ryan Fitzpatrick. I swear to God.
It hit the music perfectly.
Fitzmagic's
too.
Brother?
Brendan Fitzpatrick. He went to NAU. Yeah.
Okay, real quick. What's your favorite dinosaur?
Mine?
Yeah.
I like a handful of them, but I think just searching for different types of dinosaurs, I like the Thesaurosaurus.
All right. You're not going to take it seriously.
No, he's not.
No,
he's not.
Because we have to go to break.
You're taking it seriously?
I am.
Because we have to go to break.
He's not.
I don't care
which one. I don't know. I do like Stegosaurus.
You got to care. Okay.
Who's the big giant friendly doofus?
You
got to
care about everything on this show.
Who's the big giant friendly doofus? Brontosaurus.
All right.
I'll take Brontosaurus.
Cool.
For 500. All right, we'll be right back on the Downbeat.
Me?
Whoever.
Take it out of a break?
Think you can handle it?
No, I don't know, man. It's been a long time. I don't have that stroke back yet.
Dude, you're on fire.
This is the Downbeat. And you were listening to 97.1 The Freak. And this is the last day of our first week of this.
Woo!
How about it?
Slow clap.
Are we all going to chill pretty hard this week?
Oh my God, I'm going to sleep so well.
I'm not talking to anyone for 48 hours.
Right.
Like I told Christina, my throat's kind of hurting. She's like, it's probably because you're just talking all day, every day. I'm like, yeah, it's been a while since we've done that.
Yeah.
And the vaping.
Man, I'm going to go out and get drunk every single night starting tonight, man.
Starting in the Sunset Lounge.
That's right. That's right. It's time to get it turned up.
I did confirm Barney's shooting locations, as we discussed in the last episode. Uh-huh. The show was actually filmed in three different studios, all in the North Texas area. The original tapes were filmed in Dallas. The first couple seasons were shot at Color Dynamic Studios in Allen. They would later move to the studios at Las Colinas in Irving, Texas, and then to Carrollton.
Yeah, they were right next to the Bally Sports Southwest studios
they
for
were,
years.
Yeah, right across the parking lot.
Like, that and Wishbone and other stuff was filmed there.
What's Wishbone?
Oh, my
the
God.
Dog.
That sounds cute as hell.
You would love it. About,
I'm gonna, I gotta see
yeah, like 25 years ago, probably, at
maybe,
this point.
But I loved that
classic.
Show. So it's a little dog that would, like, solve mysteries and stuff, but he would talk.
Oh, look at him. Looks like he's wearing... Oh, he's got a little hat.
Yeah.
You know Wishbone, Mike?
I don't.
I think we need to get you a puppy dog. What are your thoughts on that?
I'm kind of against sharing my abode with other living creatures.
I think you would love it, though. I said it at your housewarming party. Because you have a nice backyard.
Yeah, yeah, I probably would. And my young daughter has been after me to get
really?
One. But, golly, I don't know. I'm kind of digging my scene too much as is.
You mean the responsibility that it would foist upon you?
Yeah,
or?
Yeah. I don't like responsibility, Mike.
Dude.
Let him take care of Simon for one day, and he'll want a dog.
Yeah, you want a dog sit? You can doggy rental Simon for 24 hours.
Let me think about it.
Okay.
Simon's as sweet as they get.
I know.
It'll be
I love
easy.
Simon.
I know you love Simon.
Yes, I do. How big is he now?
Probably 60 pounds. He looks about the same.
Yeah.
Yeah. He'll love you.
I'll love him back.
He loves
dog.
Everyone.
I'm just terrified to get another dog because I don't think they'd be as perfect as Simon.
Yeah. Good
you
luck.
Because some dogs are psychos. You
it's
got
a
dog?
Crab shoot for
you
sure.
You got a dog, Gruber?
I do not. I've been living in apartments and stuff most of the last 10, 15 years, so just never quite felt right. And then, especially before getting back into this thing, working freelance and all the crazy hours and all that, just didn't feel fair to have a doggy.
Yeah.
A doggo.
Going to get you into a nice duplex here, Shoopy.
All right. Can we move in together?
Yeah, you
bet.
Each get half of a duplex, and then you get one dog to share.
Perfect.
There's a little doggy door between them, so you don't even have to see each other. Bring this to Shoopy.
Go back to Shoopy. Dog's just confused as hell. Wait,
I don't know. Who the hell's Shoopy? Everyone is Shoopy, it seems. I hate this. I hate it here.
Come on, Shoopy.
We're going to talk some haunted houses at 5 o'clock, because Christina and I took a journey to a haunted house, and I rolled audio, unknown to her.
Mm-hmm.
So hopefully we hear some funny stuff at 5 o'clock.
Embarrassing.
Groove's Audio Dynamite at 5:30, Big Natural Tweets at 6 o'clock, and then, of course, the Sunset Lounge. And I'll tell you this, used to do this on Cirque back in the day. I've been keeping a close eye and a very attuned ear to what's been going on the station all week. And I will reveal my station rankings in the Sunset Lounge.
Oh.
All of you. One of you did worse than everyone else, and one of you was number one. And you'll find out at 6:30. If you want to know after 1 week, the current station rankings.
So for last, like, do we have to do something?
I think you're kicked out.
Yeah, like, oh, no.
we're running lean and mean. We're not kicking anybody out just yet. Don't worry, darling, you're not last.
Okay, good.
You're fine. Do not sweat that at all.
All right.
But it'll be fun, as always, as it always is, in the Sunset Lounge as we chill. But right now, it's time for this.
Sport report.
Can't.
Two for two, getting Krystina on the sport report.
Nailed
open.
It.
I was cracking up right when he played it. It's like, you know what's coming. You know what's going to happen.
I have three sport that I'm prepared to report on, and they all three have one thing in common. That is foul play, cheating, allegations of improper behavior. And those three sports, I want you to rank these three sports, you know, you'll see. I mean, activities, whatever you want to call
okay.
them. Mike, rank these three in the order that you've done most recently to the longest since you've done it.
Okay.
Chess, fishing, dancing.
Most recent, dancing. Second most would be chess, and third, fishing.
Last time you fished?
Probably when I was a teenager.
Really?
Yeah. I don't fish much.
I don't like fishing either. Do you like fishing?
Well, do you just not the whole getting it off the hook part, or?
I just don't care.
The whole thing? Yeah.
It's hot out there.
When you talk about fishing, you got to take the whole thing into account.
And you do have to wake up super early.
Super early?
Yeah.
I love boating.
Yeah. But I haven't fished probably since I was like 6 or 7.
Yeah.
I barely even remember it. But my dad would take us, and we'd have to wake up super early and go out there. And so I've
were
never
you into it.
I think we liked it. I remember liking it, but not putting a worm on the hook or trying to get the fish off the hook. I was terrified.
I like the boating part, and I do have fond memories of fishing with my dad. I guess way back in the day on a couple occasions. But I mean, I'm a full-on grown adult. I could be fishing anytime I want, and I have almost no urge to go fishing.
What about noodling?
I'm not going to go noodling. You know what noodling is?
I don't think so.
Okey noodling?
No. Clue me in.
I don't know that
maybe
I'm...
Maybe this is something I want to do.
Maybe. I'll probably get this very wrong, and some okey will be pounding their dashboard with a fist, but I think it's essentially fishing for giant catfish in lakes.
They talked about it on the speakeasy, I think, just yesterday.
Oh, really?
But, like, you find a catfish nest, which that was news to me, too. They have nests out there, and you stick your arm down there.
You stick your arm,
and
like...
Just grab them?
You stick your arm, like, down their throat. And I think you hook your hand around maybe their gills.
Ooh!
And then you just pull that thing out, and that thing's going to be up halfway to your elbow.
That is a little bit too stout for me.
I agree.
You don't want to do that?
No, I don't want to do that. What happens if something goes wrong and he bites your arm off?
I don't think it
very
could.
Possible.
Well, I think
is
that,
it?
I don't know.
I think it's not possible.
I think
possible.
It is. I think it
I'm
is.
I'm optimistic, so yes, it's possible.
I don't know
I think
if that's,
optimistic. Pessimistic.
Have you ever done this?
Hell no. I just said I don't like fishing. I don't like any form of it.
Okay.
But you know what? If somebody invited me fishing, I would politely decline. I liked in Florida, you do some deep sea fishing every now and again. That was fun. I don't know. I just don't like fishing that much. I don't like dancing either, but dancing we'll start with. Irish dancing rocked by allegations of competitive fixing involving dance teachers and judges. And this is the one I have the least amount of information on, so I'm glad it's the one that you've done most recently. And when you say dancing, is that just sort of dancing during a petty theft show? Are you counting that as your dancing?
No, I'm not counting that.
Okay, so when did you dance most recently?
At a wedding I went to not too long ago.
That's fair. The prestigious global body that governs Irish dancing rocked by allegations of competitive fixing and cheating. An Comisium Lerincia Galentia.
Yep.
Dealing with its largest ever alleged cheating scandal. Basically judges fixing competitions. But the only interesting part here is one case, a dance teacher and a competition judge appeared to be exchanging sexual favors for higher scores.
Whoa.
I knew it.
All that money you had on.
I always knew something was going on there.
Well, I thought that was funny, but that's the least interesting of the three. Chess and fishing remain. Let's move on to chess. And I know you like chess, and I know you've done a What's on Mike's Mind in the past about chess.
Yes.
And I believe Magnus Carlsen,
yes.
He's a fascinating young man, the world's number one chess player.
Oh, man, he is awesome.
Well, did you know that not too long ago, Magnus Carlsen, the number one chess player in the world, lost? He lost to a 19-year-old chess player named Hans Moke Niemann. Okay?
Did not know this.
After the match, Carlsen claimed that Niemann had cheated. Evidence has shown that he had cheated numerous times in recent years while playing online, because online chess is a big thing as well. Mm-hmm. But it's been difficult to determine how he could have cheated live in person in game. So the internet starts to investigate how one might cheat at a live chess tournament. Do you have any guesses at all? How could a human have an interaction with someone else at an independent location that could essentially let you know what chess pieces to move where while you're sitting in a room in a chair unable to move?
Maybe slip everybody there a Mickey. It'll knock them out for 20 seconds or so.
Okay.
It's a good way. No one would ever know.
Yeah, and then they come to?
Yeah.
And no one's the wiser. And
you're like, that's right.
You're on the clock, bub.
Right.
They don't even know that anything happened.
Your move. Well, it was suggested that Niemann may have been receiving a signal through vibrating anal beads.
Okay. I can see how something like this could happen.
Some people thought a C-ring might also be one of the two options.
Why are those the only two options? Like, what are these people doing?
Well, what? How else are you going
to... Trying to have a little fun while they're playing chess. Just trying to get a little buzz.
It's boring sometimes.
But I want to question the people who immediately were like, oh, he's cheating with anal beads. Totally. It could totally happen.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't want to hear you saying that.
Sorry. He said it first.
That's him. You're you.
But, Mike, as someone who knows...
I expect it out of him.
You know about Magnus Carlsen.
Yes.
He's an unstoppable force.
I've never seen anybody focus on anything the way he is able to focus on chess.
So this controversy has been going wild for a few weeks now.
The anal bead chess controversy, huh?
Sorry, I laughed over it.
You want it again?
No.
Probably better not to.
I could duplicate it.
So the U.S. Chess Championships are going on right now as we speak. And this young man, Hans Moke Niemann, who's been the center of all this allegation and confusion and, you know, cheating thoughts... Enter.
You got a picture of him?
Yeah, I'll find you one.
All right, let me see, and I'll tell you if this guy did it or not.
Oh!
Just by looking at him?
Yeah.
Okay. I love it.
Okay.
I love it.
I'm very familiar with what guys who are into anal beads look like.
He's sitting at a chessboard. He's got a smile on his face, and he looks like he's very feeling pleasure. There you go. Mike is looking.
Uh-huh.
There is no doubt he did it.
Case closed. Well, they were concerned he was going to do it again as he entered the building for the United States.
Of course he is.
The United States Chess Championship. I think a metal detector is standard operating procedure just for the security of the event.
Mm-hmm.
But they had like a handheld metal detection device, and they gave Hans Moke Niemann full searching, longer than they gave anyone else. And see, when you hear this audio, if you can hear when the announcers realize that they are very much focusing the metal detector on his backdoor region.
Yes, and also you can see now on our screens Hans Niemann, everybody's checked carefully. But right. What was interesting, the arbiter said yesterday during the technical meeting that no matter what, the time will start, yes, of the clock.
We will start at yes. one, said Frank Guadalupe. Yes, our chief arbiter whispered is the chief arbiter for the ladies.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Sure.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And
Marina is like, come on. Let's get going.
And you see there's somebody else being wanted in the back.
So they are focusing on his backside.
And boy, they're having a good yuck about it too, weren't they?
Did they do the prison check like you guys
didn't do the peekaboo street.
I mean, if he's accused of that.
Yeah, and everybody's whispering about it, talking about it.
Why not? Why not volunteer? Hey.
Yeah, have a look-see.
Go ahead, guys.
Because he's probably doing it. Well, he won. Niemann won his first round battle against GMU to advance to the second round. We're going to keep an eye on this story, Mike.
Let's do.
Fishing. And now, why did I go to bed last night listening to an hour-long podcast about fishing? Which I actually did. This is an interesting story. I don't know if anybody saw this, but fishing tournaments, massive thing, Mike. You're certainly aware of those.
Mm-hmm.
And we had the Lake Erie Walleye Trail. It was wrapping up its championship event on last Saturday in Cleveland's Gordon Park. It's right on the shores of Lake Erie. And we had Jason Fisher. He was the tournament director, right? And okay. His job at the end of the tournament is to look at and weigh all the fish that come from all the teams. It's
right.
Two-man teams. 30 elite, two angler teams is what they had.
His last name is really Fisher?
That had not clicked for me. Absolutely.
That's what got him the job.
Yeah.
So there's three main ways to cheat in fishing. Anglers can catch fish ahead of time, stash them in a secret location somewhere in the lake, or leave them with an accomplice somehow and retrieve them during the tournament. I have no idea if the tournament's 1 hour or 6 hours. It's probably closer to the latter, but
yeah.
You have 6 hours to catch them. But why not catch monster walleyes, hide them over here, and then, hey, look what I just caught. That's the biggest one. They can pack the fish full of ice to add weight, and then the incriminating evidence melts before it can be detected. And the other one is they can simply stuff the fish full of lead weights and hope nobody notices. So Jason Fisher, the tournament director, was weighing the anglers of boat number 12. That's Chase Kaminsky and Jake Runyon. They brought their five fish catch up for weighing. And they're about to win the Team of the Year honors and the $30,000 and various prizes that comes with it. The score they needed to beat was 16.89 pounds. And their catch weight, 33.91
Whoa.
Pounds.
They lapped it.
They lapped it. And this is 30 teams, and they basically, yeah, they lapped.
Destroyed them.
Second place.
Max Verstappen them.
Okay. And the judge, Jason Fisher, is holding these fish. He knows approximately what these fish weigh. This guy's a lifetime fisherman. He's from this lake. And he starts looking at these fish, and he's like, I don't know, dude, something's weird. So he kneels down behind one of the fish. He takes out a fillet knife to slit open the belly of the fish. He reaches in with his finger. And this happens.
We got weights and fish!
There we go!
Oh my god, they're so mad!
Well, that's quite an uprising.
Because of weights and fish.
We got weights and fish!
There we go!
Grooves could have played
it. WTF.
Oh my god.
What the? Grooves could have played that audio for the next 10 minutes, and I didn't play it because it's not worth his time to beep it all out. Because every other angler in this tournament surrounds these dudes, Runyon and Kaminsky, and they are going to beat their A. Like, these fishermen are like, they all think they're kind of alpha dudes. There's a lot of money in this, tons of damn money. And we got weights and fish.
We got weights and fish!
He starts pulling out these huge lead weights.
Oh my god!
And he was even pulling out like fillets of fish.
Like it's insane watching everything that's being taken out of these fish.
Yeah, it's like the shark belly, just all this metal, all this stuff. So, and they're standing there taking it. Eventually, until Fisher said, "You guys get out of here because you're about to get killed."
Yeah.
Or certainly beat the hell out of.
Because of weights and fish.
And they're yelling to call the police. They're like,
"We got weights and fish."
I mean, the crowd surges forward, and Fisher's like, "Jake, I want you to leave. I don't want anyone to touch these guys." And then this guy just stands there, like, head down, like, knowing you're as busted as you could possibly be. And they start yelling, "How many blanking tournaments have you done this, MF? Don't need to file a police report. They're trying to call 911. Where's your crown now?"
Oh, my God.
Like, fishermen losing their minds. One guy said, "You were the champ, dude."
Let us all down.
Say it ain't so, Joe.
Overfishing.
We all blank and knew it.
Oh my god.
But yeah, overfishing is one way to say it. But estimates that Runyon and Kaminsky have taken in somewhere around $400,000 in winnings and endorsements coming into this past weekend.
So that's all going to get taken away now, right?
Among their victories,
that'll make them give it back.
Their victories, Runyon and Kaminsky both won both of the most two lucrative events of the 2021 season. Those would be, if you're wondering, the Fall Brawl and the Walleye Slam. Why are you laughing at fishing so much?
It's all very funny to
it's
me.
Like
any, yeah, wait, yeah.
This is not a laughing matter.
I mean, like, I know people take it really seriously, but it's just funny that they're taking it that seriously.
But think of these guys cheating, right? The Fall Brawl, they won that. There were 10,574 anglers in it. And they win. That's shocking.
Yeah.
And then they win the Walleye Slam, which had 7,355 entrants in it. And you go back-to-back in those. And one guy's quote was, "Outside of Tiger Woods, the world's best golfer in the world isn't going to win four or five tournaments in a row. And it's even way more of a long shot in fishing. You just can't go on a hot streak like this unless you're straight up cheating." And they got busted.
No,
we got weights and fish!
Because they were putting weights in damn fish, Mike.
The Walleye Slam sounds like a Kool-Aid Man thing.
The Walleye Slam?
Like that should be their logo.
That's some good reporting on that story.
Isn't that interesting?
Yes.
And I want to surprise you, Mike. I've entered us into a local fishing tournament as a two angler team.
Let's go.
It's going to be me and you out there.
Let's go.
We're just going to catch one tiny fish.
We're going to have cane poles.
I don't know. We're going to rent it from the local shop, the bait shop, and see if... I bet we wouldn't finish dead last. We would. Out of 10,000.
All I've ever fished with is a cane pole.
Is that just like a
bamboo?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Bamboo pole with a little line on it?
Yeah.
Did you catch anything?
Oh, yeah. Not much or not big, but there probably wasn't much or big in the place where I was fishing.
If some local guy had a great boat, I mean, cooler full of beer, nice area to sit, comfortable, would you go have a nice afternoon of fishing?
Yeah. We can find that.
All right. Let's open up the phones. Take the Downbeat Fishing. We'll go have the time of our lives. All right. That's Fringe Sport Fracases. Fringe Sport Funny Business. And I hope we all learned something today. All right. Coming up next, it is Fun Drive. And Krystina and I went to a haunted house, and we have audio from it. Plus, we'll find out why Mike Rhyner says, "I love haunted houses." That's next on 97.1 The Freak.
It's Shoopy.
Shoopy.
Gerb just Shoopy. Handed me a Dr. Pepper.
Hell yeah.
Boy, look at that.
We are caffeinated.
Yeah, not in a can. The bottled one.
That's right.
It makes a difference.
Makes a huge difference.
It hits different, as right. The kids say.
It does hit different.
I've fallen into the trap of drinking diet sodas, so I haven't had the full experience in a very long time.
And?
I love it. You mean to pound this thing and burp?
No. Although that was very funny.
You know, if you're going to do it to begin with, go all in.
What, if you're going to soda?
Yeah. If you're going to soda, go all in. Screw the diet. Go all in.
Dude, no.
Although, dude, yeah.
Well, no, there's 210 calories in this.
And?
And there's none in a diet Dr. Pepper.
Aren't those worse for you, though?
People say that.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Because it's like
I don't know why we all have cancer.
Look, none of them are good for
you. Everything we're doing is terrible for
yes.
you.
Yes. Nothing is good.
So just go all in.
Go all in.
I imagine the food with all the preservatives might be the main cause of...
Yeah.
But drinking soda all day every day is probably not a great idea either.
You don't have to drink it all day every day.
Well, we as a society do.
Have
oh,
to?
You were speaking of the royal we.
Indeed.
Yeah.
The royal okay. scam.
See the glory.
See the glory of a brand new segment called Groob's Audio Dynamite, which I'm very much looking forward to. It's Gruber. He just compiles things that are funny, some old, some new, and we'll see what he's got in his bag here in about 20 minutes or so. And after that, you can still get in on Big Natural Tweets. We will read a Twitter that's been sent to @DownbeatDFW. Select a few. See if we can put Mike in some compromising scenarios with some tweets. See how you wriggle out of it. We're not scared of their tweets, so we're going to just compile them.
Not scared of them either.
And we're going to let them damn rip. And then you know the last segment of the day is the Sunset Lounge. We'll have a little fun there as well. But right now, Groobs, do it. God.
Friday is over. Time to see my stupid family. Building. Keyboard. Creamer. Fun guy.
Probably the best open we have.
Yeah. That sports one is incredible.
You yelling, building keyboard creamer. As Groobs and I...
We literally walked around this office
yeah.
just naming things that we saw.
You just wanted Groobs to yell crap that you'd find in an office?
Yeah.
Like, I don't know, creamer's funny.
Slack's projector boss.
Yeah, Slack's projector boss. Building.
That's probably the most generic.
Microphone.
Yeah.
Yeah, we didn't get that technical.
Creamer.
We're thinking about
yeah,
the office,
them.
Yes,
office
yes,
jocks.
Yep,
yeah.
Because this is yep. not for us. This yep. is for them. They
not
work
the cool
hard.
People like us.
And now they're heading home to see their stupid family. It's time for Fun Drive. So you're in your car. We can see you out there on the tollway right now. Blue Chevrolet.
What's up?
Red truck. Well,
we
listening.
Salute you. We yeah. hope you're by the channel.
And if you want to stick the fist out the window here in Fist City, USA,
go right ahead.
I don't know if you should call it that.
Give two taps of the horn. See what happens.
Give it an old Zombieland double tap. And we'll take it. And speaking of zombies, we're going to talk about some scary things right now. As you hear Krystina taking a deep breath.
Yep. I'm going right back to it.
Because I've never seen her as terrified as I saw her.
It was bad.
6 days ago, Michael. Is we not only entered a home, a barn, another facility that I don't know what it really is in the real world. We don't own these places. Who enters a barn or a home that's not yours? Especially one that you know for damn sure that is haunted.
I can think of only one reason for that. One circumstance where you might do that. And that is, as Halloween approaches and you're in a haunted house.
A haunted house, indeed. You got it. You got it right. Not just a haunted house. Most certainly the oldest haunted house in the great state of Texas.
Cheers.
And possibly the oldest haunted house in the country. The Reindeer Manor.
Mm-hmm.
In Red Oak, Texas. Krystina invited me. She was invited by the people that run Reindeer Manor, and she quickly said, no, I don't want to go there, man. Out.
I did try to pass it off to KT.
Because it's part of the station thing, right? They
right.
wanted somebody to come check yep. it out, send a couple Insta posts.
Yeah.
So what did you do? Overturn that decision and say, no, we're going?
Well, she said no, and then she realized that she has someone there to protect.
With an athletic build.
And she knows that I will protect. And tell them why you know.
Do you want me to tell the story?
Yeah.
So we were in Italy. And we had been drinking quite a bit. And we're staying in this villa with all these other people.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, I don't know, about midnight, 1 o'clock. It's right in the middle of the night. And all of a sudden, I hear Mike just go, "Protect!" And he leans over with his arm, and he grabs me. He says, "I must protect." And I look at him. I wake up. I'm like, are you okay? And he's sleeping, obviously, because sometimes he'll talk in his sleep. But he
like that?
He yelled it. He's never done that before. And then he said it again. I was like, are you okay?
Yeah.
He's like, I'm going to protect.
I said, I protect.
I protect.
See?
And
even when I'm asleep, I'm on the job.
He's always protecting. And so now I have this necklace that says protect on here.
Oh. Got her neck. Because it's funny.
Yeah. It was hilarious at the
her
time.
Her necklace says protect.
Because right after he did it, I was terrified because it woke me up.
Yeah.
And that, then that once...
that backfired.
Once the I realized everything was nothing okay.
Nothing would scare you.
I started laughing, so...
Yeah, but she's under my protect.
So times.
Were you, like, dreaming?
Apparently, yeah. Yeah, some mad Italians were coming for her, I think. I have no idea. I don't have any recollection of it, but... She knows that I protect.
Okay, cool, Mike.
You don't remember one thing about this.
Nothing at all. No.
I told that story immediately the next morning when we were having breakfast.
Yeah,
and
that's what this idiot did.
Yeah, and he was like, wait, I did what?
So she was invited to this haunted house, the Reindeer Manor, and she said no. And then she realized that she has someone to protect.
Yep.
And she's like, do you want to go? And I said, what is the talent fee? And she told me and agreed to split it. And I said, damn right, I want to go.
Well done.
I want to go see this thing. Yeah, that's how you do it. And I like haunted houses. And I'd like to hear, before we even get into the specifics of our adventures, Mike, when I brought this story up, you said, I like haunted houses.
It's been a long time since I've been to one.
Mm-hmm.
Because I haven't felt the need to protect in more recent years. But when I did go to some, I liked them quite a bit.
Really?
Yeah. I'd do one.
You would do one?
Yeah. I would.
I don't know if I should even do this on the air, if it's appropriate, but I would like to announce, Krystina, you are obviously under my protection, and from this moment henceforth, for the rest of the time we work together, Mike Rhyner, I protect.
You're going to protect me?
I protect. Yeah, I'm going to protect you from... I'm going to protect you from now on. Okay?
I need it.
Yeah. He's good at it.
So, if in the next... What?
Nothing.
If in the next 3 weeks you find a haunted house you want to go to and you need... You know what?
Protect.
Yep. You invite me. When was the last one you went to? Any idea?
Oh, God. It must have been in the late 80s or early 90s, mm-hmm. probably when Jordan was a little girl.
Okay. Did you take her? Or you just went without her?
I'm sure we took her.
Really?
Yeah.
To a haunted house?
Yeah.
I think I would be traumatized.
Nothing scares that kid.
Okay.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, there's different levels. Some of them are clearly made for kids. Some of them are made for, like, teens.
Yeah.
They go all the way up. There's one in L.A. or in California somewhere. It's something Manor. And, like, it's been shut down. Like, they will, like...
They touch you.
They like lock you in like a refrigerator that's half full of water. Damn it! What is it? Something Manor.
Why you do that?
What? There,
I won't say the park we used to go to, but we used to go to another haunted house park every year. But then the last time we went, it was just so laughably bad. And if I'm not scared, because I get scared pretty easily at these things,
mm-hmm.
that's bad.
It's called McCamey Manor. Listen to this. McCamey Manor is considered a pioneer of extreme haunted attractions. Founded in San Diego, originally located on his property. Ooh, the house operates year-round, offering visitors a tour that can last up to 8 hours.
Mm-mm.
No. How long you're going to this place for. Guests must sign a liability waiver to participate. Items on the waiver list include inability to leave the experience without the staff's permission. And being subjected to various forms of physical and psychological torture, including... Okay,
what?
The waiver says, including having bones broken, teeth removed...
What?
And being drugged.
No! How is that legal?
Well, that's the... I think that's on the waiver. They're definitely not going to do those things, but that's... Everything is designed to scare you, so I think part of it is the...
All right.
The waiver. You can look at YouTube videos of this easily.
But if you're signing it, they can actually do it.
Yeah. They're not going to pull your teeth out.
You don't know that.
You don't know that. She got you there.
Yeah, Mike.
The tour lasts from 8 to 10 hours, but no guest has made it all the way through. And they originally did not allow safe words on the tour, but apparently they've instituted safe words that can end the tour immediately.
All right. How can they come up with enough stuff to scare you for 8 to 10 hours?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll just read this. During the tour, employees of the manor may physically assault patrons, waterboard them, force them to eat and drink unknown substances, have them bound and gagged, and engage in other forms of physical and psychological torture.
How is that fun?
Well, look, I think if you take the question of why is going to a haunted house fun, because it's eliciting an emotional response. You watch a comedy, you laugh. You watch a scary movie, you get startled. Your heartbeat raises. It's an emotional response. That's why the haunted house that we went to and the ones that are all opening up right now are in business, because it's something abnormal. I know. But I'm saying that it's the exact reason why you seek that emotional response, albeit in a 5% amount. Theoretically, to some people, they would want it at 100%.
They didn't gag you last night, did they?
They didn't gag me or touch us in any way. As we tell you how great Rand...
This sounds like fun.
They got pretty damn close, though.
No, they didn't.
Yes, they did.
To what, gagging you? No.
No, just to touching me, and I don't like being touched by strangers.
Anyway, don't go to McCamey Manor.
Unless you want to be waterboarded.
Unless you want to have all your teeth pulled out. I like how it says on the thing, teeth removed without anesthesia.
Oof.
Just in case you thought they were going to take good care of you.
So what if you needed a tooth pulled and you just can't afford it? So you're like, you know what?
Yeah, go to McCamey.
Please pull my tooth.
How many people go to this thing?
You know what? I will do it. After, I will do a full research project on McCamey Manor.
Okay.
And I'll deliver it later in the month as we get close.
It's Halloween.
To the devil's birthday. And my mom, Vida's birthday.
Halloween. Hi, Vida.
So McCamey Manor project begins this weekend. Right now, Reindeer Manor Halloween Park. Whole lot more fun.
It was fun.
So we decided to go. It's in Red Oak. Christina drove her brand new car, which was fun to ride, and it looks beautiful.
2019 Jeep Compass.
And down to Red Oak we go. I didn't even really know where Red Oak was.
Not that far from here.
Not at all. 20 minutes from my house.
Yeah.
And in we go, and you walk us through, I guess, the experience of arriving there.
Okay, so you arrive, and it's just a giant field that you have to park in, and then you have to walk from said empty field to where this thing is. And so that alone was kind of scary. You're just walking in this dark, empty field.
And as much as I protect, part two is I wind her up.
Yeah.
So there's a cone. I'm like, just so you know, as soon as you walk past that cone, the official haunted house thing has started.
Yeah.
So they is not true. We still have like 100 yards to walk before we can get to the entrance. But we got to get her on edge. You got to get her head wrong.
Which
for this.
She did.
Not right.
Multiple times, because I hate haunted houses. So yeah, we're walking, again, open field. There's like a forest over here, and he says that crap, so I'm expecting someone to jump out of the forest. But anyway, so we walk and...
It was like a police officer standing there. I'm like, yeah, I ain't no police officer, I tell you that.
And he was like the nicest guy
yes,
ever.
Yes, I am. Welcome.
So we finally go down the path and actually get into the park, and we get our passes and go in, and we get the VIP line. And there's four different houses, not really houses, but four different haunted houses to go to. And so... And even while you're walking in this giant theme park, which is incredibly cool, there are people dressed up as different scary things, like one guy with a mask and a chainsaw, which I hate chainsaws. I hate them. But he's walking around, coming up behind people and just, you know, pulling it and making it go off right behind them.
Yeah, to be clear, this is not just a haunted house. This is a property, like a farm. Yeah, and there's all this area between. I think they had food and drink, and there's, you know, little... Carney's shows, kind of, and
yeah, they had
like a fun experience within just the middle part.
There was a lot. Like, there were people doing the Thriller dance and stuff, and they also had, like, drag shows going on one night, and it's a whole fun thing, fun experience.
Drag shows in Red Oak?
Yeah. Weird, right? So
does anybody just wear a devil suit for Halloween anymore?
Just a devil suit?
Yeah. The garden variety devil suit.
Just a red...
Yeah. Maybe a little mask thing with horns and a little fake pitchfork.
Like the original Hocus Pocus. There's a guy that wore that.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure the devil is still Probably a top 20 costume every year.
What's just another? Sexy devil now.
Yeah,
yeah, it is.
Sexy devil.
Another segment for you.
Latex.
So we're going in here again. There's four different haunted houses. Two of them are actually like legit big houses that you have to walk into.
They're like barns.
That
they convert. And two of them are kind of rinky-dink haunted houses.
So the first one we went in was a rinky-dink, if you will. It still was pretty badass, in my opinion. And it was a 3D.
Was it like for kids?
This is for, I mean, teens.
Kind of a junior haunted house.
Oh, the first one?
Yeah.
Kind of an easy one.
There were some high school kids there that were like, oh, I wasn't scared at all. While I'm just, you know, shivering all over the place. The first one we went in was a 3D one where you get some 3D glasses when you go in there. And there's, like, this paint everywhere and a black light.
Kind of like what you get with Butt Bongo Fiesta.
That's a callback.
It's a callback and he couldn't even get it out.
Oh, my God.
Butt Bongo.
That was like my second week on the hard line. And
he dropped that one?
Yeah. What a treat to think about that again.
Thank you, Mike.
Welcoming you aboard, Shoopy.
It's good to be back, Shoopy.
Anyway, so, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, you're fine.
I'm knocking the wheels off of
you. No, we like that. You can do that anytime.
It's fun drive. It's okay.
Yeah. Yes. So that was the 3D one, and they would have people like jump out. That was more of kind of a clown theme, which I don't like, and I don't think a lot of people do. But that one was okay. I was like, all right, I can handle that. We got through that maybe in 5 minutes. If
not even.
5 minutes, like three. Went through the little maze, got out.
She was speed walking, so the experience lasted a little less than it could for some.
I can't help but speed walk, especially when I'm scared out of my mind. So the next one, we went to one of the big ones, one of the barns.
Okay.
This was the scariest one.
Yes.
Ever. To the point where it was this the one with the preacher and all of that?
Yes.
And the caskets? Okay.
Let's just play the audio.
Okay.
We have about 2 minutes of audio. It's been condensed down. This took us probably 8-12 minutes to get through.
It was way too long.
Like, you'll hear halfway through, we get out to the back, and she's like, okay, is this the exit? I'm like, oh, no. We're going back in. We're going upstairs. We had a lot more work left to do. This is Krystina walking through, I think it's the 13th Street Morgue.
Yeah.
And I'm behind her holding a phone nearby so we can pull the audio. And here she is.
Okay, cool. Which one? The pumpkin heads. Okay.
You could have just said pumpkin heads.
They hold the nuts. They have to give me their nuts.
We'll explain that.
I'm used to holding all the nuts.
Okay.
That's how this works.
Look out for Krystina. She's a real pistol.
Don't go through there.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yep.
Snow, they're gonna pop out of it.
Yep. I know.
Oh, yes!
Okay.
Good one!
Oh,
A plus!
Oh, God.
Okay. There's definitely nothing in there.
Yep.
Alright, outside. Time to take a breather and reassess.
There's gonna be something in this car.
There's clearly there's nothing.
There's gonna be something in the car.
There's nothing of concern.
Oh, okay.
There's gonna be something in this car.
Can we walk around the car?
I will.
Oh, damn it. Okay. Sorry.
I wouldn't walk around that car.
Oh my God.
There's
caskets everywhere.
Where
no, nothing. They're opening. They're all opening. Oh my God. Okay.
Alright, let's go back. I think the exit's back there.
No, it's on! Oh my God! Mike!
I thought the exit was back there! I'm sorry!
Okay, alright, well, that's cool. That's great.
Oh! That's great!
Oh my God.
Alright, that's the last we'll see of him. Now he's done.
No. Not getting it done after that.
Your thoughts?
I really can't do that anymore.
What?
I'm terrified.
That's only two of four.
Those images will be haunting me. There was a guy like doing, I don't even know what he was doing with his body. There was a skeleton in the bathtub and I just, I'm not
crying. I can't. I'm about to start crying. I cannot do it. Oh, my God.
You good?
I'm good.
All right. Let's go hit number three.
No. No.
That was it?
Okay.
No.
So I definitely legit wanted to be done after that second one. I was absolutely terrified. So I forgot at the beginning of it, you go up to this door and they kind of turn the lights off where you can't see anything.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm trying to open this door and they turn the lights off and I'm like, crap, I don't know how to get in here. And all of a sudden this guy opens a slit right in front of you and he looks like Frankenstein and
yeah,
yells in your face.
That's the drop window.
Damn it. Yep. And then you're walking through here and there's this guy who deserves an Emmy for the award that he did. You walk around a corner and he's sitting in this chair and he's got blood all over him and he's just looking to the side like kind of hyperventilating. And then he gets up and he runs the direction that you have to freaking walk. So like, yeah, okay, cool. I guess I'll follow this scary kid because I have no choice. And then you keep walking and you kind of forget about him. But Mike mentioned in that clip, like, oh, we'll never see that guy again. There's no way.
We're clear.
So we get towards the end and this hall just lights up and that guy is doing like a backbend thing.
Yeah, if you're a wrestling fan, it's the Bray Wyatt maneuver where he's basically, he's on his hands and feet, but his back is facing down and his chest is up.
My God.
Like how do you, however you do that?
Like yeah.
Like that and his whole arch. And he's like crawling toward you.
Yes.
With his back facing the ground.
And you have to walk that way. You have to walk around him. You can't just glance at him and, you know, look the other way and run off. You have to walk towards him.
There's no way of getting around it.
And then there was another part because that was inside and you go outside before you're completely done with it. And so they had this old broken down car with a guy that just pops up on the other side of it. And then there's another, like, little tiny graveyard you have to go through. And there's this kid who's, like, 6 years old. I wish you would have gotten that audio because that was pretty funny.
Yeah.
This kid that's, like, 6 years old and he's making these zombie sounds that you have to walk right by. And then as we pass him, Mike goes, he definitely killed me in Fortnite last night.
And now he's scaring the hell out of us.
Yeah.
Dude, I loved it. And I like Haunted House is fine. But whenever I'm laughing in that audio, I was
covering it up?
No. I mean, I was startled.
Yeah.
I was not scared at any moment, but I'm there for the flash scares, you know, and four or five of them in that haunted house alone got me.
I will say, after the fact, I had a blast.
Right.
It was really fun.
Yeah.
But in the moment, you can hear me, I am definitely...
Well, you didn't sound like
it. I am so scared.
Dude, we got out of there, as you heard at the end, and she's like, I want to go.
I'm like,
dude, for real, we didn't come all the way up here to do two of four. We had two more of these bad boys.
I wanted to go, yeah.
And then the third one was kind of like the first one. It was real easy. You just kind of zipped through it. And the last one was much like that second one, where there's two out there that are beast haunted houses that I full recommend.
Yeah.
Good time.
But, yeah, I took a deep breath, and I did it, and I powered through, and I'm glad I did. It was really fun.
Our little hero.
It was really fun.
She did it.
Yeah.
And guess what? I protected her the whole time.
He protected.
I know you did.
You know I did.
I know you did. And I know she's a trooper, too.
Uh-oh. Is that...
That's a creepy laugh.
That's witch's brew shale right there.
Reindeer Manor in Red Oak.
Fun time. See, it's October. Go to a Halloween.
Yes, go to
house.
Red Oak.
Go to Red
For
Oak.
For all your Halloween needs, go to Red Oak.
I love it. All right, 5:28 is the time. It's the debut of yet another new segment here on the Downbeat. Coming up next, it's Groobs Audio Dynamite. We do have hoops on the Freak Tonight team. You know the,
we do indeed, don't we?
You know the Mavs only have three preseason games this season, which is the lowest amount of preseason games I think any NBA team has had in over 20 years.
Wow.
In a non-COVID year.
Yeah, I knew that seemed a little bit light for them.
Yeah.
I was not aware of that bit of data, though.
And this is their only home preseason game of the season. We do have Luka thrown on the Mavs jersey.
And we're not going?
It's preseason, honey. Still. No, we're not going.
Okay.
She wants to go to the game.
Huh?
She wants to go to the game. You need to take her to the game.
No, I want to sleep.
I don't think she really wants to go.
Yeah, we'll listen to it on our way home.
Yeah.
Right okay. here on 97 Radio Freak.
I'll put out.
Ask her if she...
You can settle your own domestic situations.
Ask her if she really wants to go to the game.
Krystina, do you really want to go to the game?
No, not really. I'm good.
Please say no.
I said no. We're good.
She did.
Yep.
Yeah, we're all good.
Yep.
You don't want to see first overall pick Paolo Banchero this evening? He plays for the Orlando Magic. He was the first pick overall. You can listen to the game on the Freak, of course, but if you choose to listen to the game with your eyes, I will tell you one thing that'll be fun to keep an eye on. The brand new Mavericks' new gray and navy court. We have a new style, a new look this year. And apparently it's bad A.
Sounds bad A.
Yeah.
Gray?
Yeah.
And instead of the normal wood color, the court is gray?
No. I think the wood maintains the same. I think it's all the lines
trim.
Out of bounds. Yeah, exactly. Gray and navy. And you know how we have every Maverick ever written on the outside of the court? Which is a good bit. Do you know that?
I didn't know
Everyone who's ever played for the Mavericks. And I feel like, is Tony Romo's name on there? I don't know if it is or not. Is written like on the exterior of the basketball court.
It's really cool.
Yeah. But this year, all the names of the 2011 championship...
Whoa.
You don't woe me. You've set the bar.
That's true.
That dumb
That's
button.
True. That's true.
True.
All right. So okay. I apologize.
I get 10 before I get woe.
You're right. I don't woe you.
All the members of the 2011 championship team, their names are written in gold right by the bench this year. I like the little things.
Is this going to be a regular thing?
Yeah.
I mean, this is the court look.
This is the first look at the new court with all that stuff I mentioned would be tonight.
Okay.
Yeah. So if you want to watch that on TV, you can do it. And if you want to just hear it described, you can do it here on the Freak.
Yes, by no less an authority than the higher authority.
That's exactly correct. It's time for something fun. Here it is.
For years, Grooves has been mining the hills of Dallas-Fort Worth and the world in search of the purest, most exquisite audio treasure our beautiful planet has to offer. Now, once a week, or whenever else the Downbeat guys run out of material, Grooves extracts these precious sonic gemstones and slides them around your neck ever so delicately to make you look and feel extra pretty, which you are. Here's Grooves' audio dynamite.
The debut.
Yes.
Oh, boy.
It is time for Grooves' Audio Dynamite. Here he is, Shoopy.
Hello, friends.
Hi.
Hi, Grooves.
Now that I'm officially a co-host, I'm just very honored to be with y'all. So I just wanted to say that.
Welcome.
It's good to be with you.
You know, though, that was one of our professionally done opens. And iHeart's pretty good. I mean, we kind of just write stuff and they do some really neat stuff.
Yeah.
I think some of the opens, believe it or not, Fun Drive, Grooves and I did.
Yeah, that was a duo production.
But we had that script written, and we had to send it to him, and it's sent off to a guy, I don't even know where he is. And I wrote Grooves, and I realized there's a very good chance he won't know how to, like he might say Grubs or not know, so I had to put in parentheses, rhymes with lubes.
I'm glad you chose that consonant to start it.
Yeah. How many other options were there? What else is Grooves?
There's enough. We don't have to talk about it.
Oh, like a P. All right.
I didn't even think of that. There are many ways to go here.
Well, Grooves is an absolute assassin at all these jobs he's had, picking incredible music, funny drops, and if you don't know what he does, hopefully you will learn over the next months and years exactly what a genius he is. But we figured he needs his own segment, Grooves Audio Dynamite. I have no idea what he has. It can be funny. It can be music. It can be anything at all. There are no rules on the station, and specifically with this segment. So, Michael Gruber, what have ye?
Well, I figure it would only be fitting if I let off the thing with a tribute to the great Norm MacDonald, who those that follow me on Twitter, which they shouldn't do, that follow me at Tweet Groobs, have known for about the last 10 years that I have looked for multiple opportunities and generally taken them to tweet out the moth joke line by line to the masses.
It's incredible.
I don't know if I've ever actually made it, like, listen or watch the entire official moth joke. I know it more from Grooves than I do from even Norm.
Yeah, so he was on Conan about 10 years ago. I think this was actually the late show when Conan was hosting it for about 7 months. And let's just let Norm take it away.
Now, not
all your material comes from the news. Is that right?
You know, my strongest material comes from real life.
Real life?
Like, for instance, today I was driving in a car. Mm-hmm. You were kind enough to bring a car to bring this old chunk of coal here to the studio.
We send cars for our guests, yes.
Yeah, so I got in it, and I get material that way, so my driver...
What do you mean? How do you get material that way? You get in the car, and what happens?
My driver tells me a joke.
The driver we sent to pick you up told you a joke?
Yeah.
And you're going to tell it now on the show?
Yeah, that's how I get a lot of my material.
Okay, why don't we just have him on next time?
That guy... Now, wait till you hear me do it. So the guy, I'll be the guy.
Okay.
A moth goes into a podiatrist's office.
A moth goes into a podiatrist's office. Right.
You are correct. A moth goes into a podiatrist's office, mm-hmm. and the podiatrist's office says, "What's the problem?" And the moth says, "What's the problem? Where do I begin, man?" He goes, "I go to work for Gregory Linovich, and all day long I work." Honestly, Doc, I don't even know what I'm doing anymore. I don't even know if Gregory Linovich knows. He only knows that he has power over me, and that seems to bring him happiness. But I don't know. I wake up in a malaise, and I walk here and there. The podiatrist says, "Oh, yeah?" And the moth goes, "Yes." And he goes, "At night I sometimes wake up and I turn to some old lady in my bed that's on my arm. A lady that I once loved, Doc. I don't know where to turn to. My youngest, Alexandria. She fell in the cold of last year. The cold took her down as it did many of us." "And my other boy." "And this is the hardest pill to swallow, Doc. My other boy, Gregorio Ivanilidovich. I no longer love him. As much as it pains me to say, when I look in his eyes, all I see is the same cowardice that I catch when I take a glimpse of my own face in the mirror. If only the cowardice was stronger, then perhaps I could bring myself to reach over to that cocked and loaded gun that lays on the bedside behind me and end this hellish facade once
and for all." How long a drive was this? Do you live in the valley? Where do you live? Please, sorry.
He says, "Doc, sometimes I feel like a spider, even though I'm a moth, just barely hanging on to my web with an everlasting fire underneath me. I'm not feeling good." And so the doctor says, "Moth, man, you're troubled. But you should be seeing a psychiatrist. Why on earth did you come here?" And then the moth said, "Because the light was on."
Hey. Oh, it's incredible.
Really, I just wanted to get back into radio so I could play that.
Man.
Adios. Why is he standing up and leaving
right,
with his backpack?
All right, see you guys later.
Yeah, we still need you.
What do you think, Mike?
Hour and 15 minutes left, Shoopy. Don't leave yet.
I'm still here.
Just hearing Conan's voice is always so... I mean, both of their voices. But for him to do such a dumb, long joke...
And he did that pretty much every time he was on with Conan, and Conan just understood the bit, let him go, and...
Did he really? Is it...
A lot of times, there's Professor of Logic joke, and...
Well, there's...
Andy Richter, the Swedish German, and... if you look up Norm MacDonald, Conan... joke on YouTube, there's some gold there.
Well, that's like Paul Rudd, too. They'll do that same bit every
the Mac
single
and
time.
Me.
Yes.
Okay. That's my Twitter header.
Dude.
Funny.
I've seen your Twitter header forever, and I don't know what the hell that thing
oh
is.
Oh, my God.
And until you told me about the Paul Rudd bit.
Yeah.
And then I finally watched it, and then... I'm like, oh my God, it's Groobs this thing.
Yeah. It's the best thing, because just like that, every single time, it's like, oh yeah, you're an Ant-Man. Let's see a preview of it.
I brought a special clip for you.
Convinces Conan every time, got him even on his last show ever. Just glorious.
Oh, so, God.
The very long bit with barely a payoff, I'm a fan of.
That's us.
I've got a couple smaller things, and then we'll end on something that me and Shell actually collaborated on. But a couple weeks ago, Jimmy Johnson was hosting the, I believe, football Fox pregame, and there might have been a noise that came from some part of his body.
I've got a shot. Because, I know we have problems at wide receiver.
He strained it.
That's a pretty good one.
He strained it.
Because.
This thing's been Zapruder'd pretty hard. Are we, because there was thoughts that it might have been Bradshaw.
Right.
But it was just. And that's what made Jimmy pause.
Because.
Definitely the sound of somebody squeezing one out.
Yeah, there's no mistaking
that part
what
is
that
confirmed.
Is. up next, I don't know if y'all heard, but the Queen Elizabeth passed away a few weeks ago.
When?
Oh, no.
A few weeks ago. Like I said.
Damn it.
I know, it's a tough thing. But
now, Mikey's
the next
doing
day,
it for the Queen today.
Yeah.
He always is.
Did it for Beau yesterday. Today's for Queen.
Ben's dog, Beau?
Yeah.
Okay.
Did it all for Beau yesterday. That's and Pope sweet. John Paul II.
We love all of them.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Equally.
The day after the Queen passed, a British news reporter decided to ask to interview a little girl and kind of see what she thought about things.
What advice would you give the King? What would you like to see him do?
Do a backflip.
What? We would all like to see him.
I'd
do
really
that.
Like to see 77-year-old King Charles.
What would you have
flip?
The king do?
A backflip.
One more. That's the cutest.
What advice would you give the king? What would you like to see him do?
Do a backflip.
The lady she's probably an Ozzie Smith fan.
Yeah, exactly.
Just
the Wizard
the
of
king
Oz.
The king comes into the court every day, just doing a backflip
at the beginning of the season. One time on day one of Parliament. He's like, all right, let's get this thing knocked out.
What would y'all do if Biden did a backflip before?
That'd be incredible.
Yeah, I know. Oh, awesome. My God.
It would kill him.
How? How?
We need Shoopy to do one, too.
Yep.
Rolling into the studio every day with the backflip.
Oh, man, if only I could do that.
We got a long hallway. You can do the full Ozzie Smith routine.
Yeah.
God, if only I could.
You can get up to speed.
Man, if I could do something like that, if I had a party trick like that, I would whip it out all the time.
All right. Give me a second to mark that.
Yep. The trick. The party trick.
I love him. Mark,
all right. And I'm back.
Okay.
So, Shell reminded me of one more thing from someone that actually shares a name with him.
Yeah. I'm so glad you unearthed this one. This might be one of my favorite pieces of audio.
This must be Shell Silverstein.
No, it's not Shell Silverstein. It's Shael Sonnen, who's a UFC fighter.
All right.
And we played it on Cirque a few times, and I just think it's the funniest thing. He's a really funny dude. He's obviously playing this very dry, and he's on his way. This is 10 years ago. He's on his way to Brazil to fight this badass dude. And he's like, oh, you're a badass because you grew up in the favelas of Brazil. But it's like, I grew up in West Lynn, Oregon, which is like upper middle class. He had the nicest neighborhood, but he's trying to act hard. So here's Shael Sonnen scaring people.
I don't know that I'm a self-proclaimed gangster. I'm from the mean streets of West Lynn, Oregon. And I've seen things and been through things that somebody like you in your little pearly loft couldn't even relate to. And if you're asking me to share stories with you that are frankly none of your business, maybe I'll give you a couple and maybe you'll take a little smug look off your face. But I can date back to when I was 11 years old. I'm minding my own business and I'm in a park. This guy, stranger to me, takes a piece of gum out of his pocket, he puts his mouth, and he just throws a wrapper on the ground. He publicly litters. He just publicly litters. And I saw that. I had to see these things at a young age. Sure, somebody came along, somebody picked it up, somebody threw it in the trash can. But for the few moments where that sat on the ground and the law was violated right here in my neighborhood? What about the time I'm on the sidewalk and I watch a guy cross the street and he's not even within the lines? He's publicly jaywalking. There was a police officer standing right there. He didn't do anything. He didn't do anything. We have chaos. We have anarchy at times in Westland. You know, you look at me. There was years where my father didn't even make $100,000. Or barely made $100,000. And sure, we had a maid, but she only came twice a week. What do you think happened the other 5 days? You think those dishes washed themselves? You think those clothes got themselves in the hamper? My neighbors were twins.
What?
They got a Mercedes for their birthday, but just one. They had to share that car. They had to share that car. Who gets to drive today? I had to see these things. You ask me about being a gangster, you think I'm scared to go to Brazil? You haven't seen the things I've seen. You haven't been down that way. You haven't been to the mean streets of Westland, Oregon.
I've forgotten how good that
okay.
is.
Legend.
That is great.
Who is that?
Shail Sonnen. He's a UFC fighter. Who was good back in the day. He's a tough SOB.
Yeah, he was a big name.
But, yeah, he's older now, but he was always really funny, and that is one of my favorite cuts.
They were jaywalking. The police officer just stood there and didn't do anything.
I had a neighbor. They were twins. They got a Mercedes. They had to share that car.
There was trash. Someone else picked it up. But
yeah, we had a maid. She only came 2 days a week.
What do you think happened the other five? I can so relate to him.
That's great.
Oh, sweet Groobs. You can.
I loved it.
Groobs Audio Yay. Dynamite! Yes. He's always compiling. He's always mining to put the necklace around our necks and make us look pretty.
Ever so delicately.
Ever so delicately. You will contribute to the program in about 5 minutes or so because it's time for Big Natural Tweets. If you want to get any buzzer beaters in, at Downbeat DFW, ask Mike Rhyner or Krystina or myself or Groobs, anything you like. We will go through those in just a moment. Probably not.
I mean, I don't remember Berline being injured or anything.
But how fascinating, 31 NFL player, and he was dominant in high school, 110 catches, 2,100 yards, and he didn't receive his first scholarship offer until 3 weeks after their final game in high school, and it was from Eastern Washington. But like, if you have that pedigree, your dad and your grandfather, and you smoke everybody in high school, wouldn't it be, should we take a look here?
We ought to.
He ended up being a third-round pick for the Rams, pick number 69.
And look at him now.
I didn't say anything.
And look at him now. And look at him indeed. 42 catches, 402 yards this year. He's on pace for a record-breaking 179 receptions. The current record is 149.
Yeah. Look at the year he had last year.
Yes. Offensive player of the year last year. And I looked it up. He only ran a 4.62 40-yard dash, which is not... raise too many eyebrows at the combine for a wide receiver.
In that world, that's, you know, kind of mediocre.
And for him to be as dominant as he is, like unstoppable, with incredible hair and a beautiful beard.
Very handsome fellow.
And wait till Diggs gets a hold of him. We'll see. You'll all see. Time for this, Groobs. So.
Baby, let's see those big natural tweets. Here's my Saroy with some mouth-watering tweets for your ear hole.
What are you doing? I like this.
I was not expecting that.
I like this. Yes.
This is what happens when I get some level of creative control.
My God.
Head away, Shoopy. I'm behind you here.
We all like Day Bow Bow, but...
Yeah.
Was that an Always Sunny?
Yes. Oh, you mean Day Bow Bow?
Day the name Bow of Bow. The song. Yeah, Day Bow Bow. You know the song. We have tweets, and they've been fired off and sent directly to us at DownbeatDFW, and let's zip through a few. Some are comments, questions. And I love this first one because this is a policy that I was unaware of that applies to you, Mike Rhyner, and I want to
the
know.
The open door policy?
Nope. H.E. Pennypacker asks, does Mike Rhyner still have a rule that NFL games if an NFL game ends without a touchdown that he won't watch Monday Night Football the next Monday.
I certainly do.
Is that something?
I certainly do.
Is it if any game...
It is my way of punishing the NFL, well, or the NFL for throwing dung out there.
I mean, I've never heard of
any game that does not have a touchdown in it, that's not a game. That is time wasted. That's time you'll never get back. Yet the NFL just, they don't care about that. They just suck it up.
I mean, this last game wasn't good.
Well, that's why it comes up. Yeah. It's because last night's game between the Colts and the Broncos was a 12-9 final in overtime, no less, in which no team stuck the ball over the plane of the end zone.
Then no Monday Night Football for me.
Guess I won't talk about it Tuesday.
Okay. Well,
I don't think we were anyway.
What are you going to do?
Yeah, fat chance of it.
Let's see who plays Monday night. Let's see what...
This is no real punishment for me now.
Who is it?
Okay, what if it was a team you wanted to watch play Monday? Like, what if the Cowboys were playing Monday?
Can't.
Man's got to have a code.
All right. No, I respect it.
We support you, Shoopy.
It is the Las Vegas Raiders against your former favorite team, the Kansas City Chiefs.
Might be a decent game. Too bad I'm going to miss.
Stick it to the NFL.
When did this policy come about? I've never heard this one. It's an old one?
It's been in place for some time now.
I kind of love it.
For about, I don't know, 12, 15 years, maybe longer than that.
Huh.
Hell, I may have brought it to the ticket with me.
And that's if any game
does
on
not
Sunday,
have a touchdown.
Any single game doesn't have a touchdown, Monday night's right out.
That's it. I'm out.
All right. Well, they checked that box last night. No Chiefs, no Raiders for you.
Too bad.
Mike Kinzer says, just like the old What's on Mike's Mind segments, it's all such greatness. I've missed it so much. Nobody can do what he does. That's you.
Oh.
See you, dog. Say a nice thank you
to
Mike.
Don't worship me till I've earned it.
Mike Kinzer said that. Talk to him. Tell him.
Yes, I am familiar with that guy. I run across him quite a bit. Thank you, sir. I appreciate it.
Cool J69, question for all today. While in your teen years, did you have a DJ that you grew up with? Personally, mine was Kid Craddock. I was floored the day he passed. He was my DJ and daily entertainment. Who was your first?
Russ Knight, the Weird Beard. On the Mighty 1190, KLIF.
What years are we talking there?
Mid-60s. Early to mid-60s.
Yep, 1962.
Yeah.
Russ the Weird Beard.
Russ Knight.
Knight, like a K and I.
Yes.
K-H-T. That's cool. All right.
That is a badass last name.
There was
name.
Him. Knight. There was. Yeah. There were others, too. Ron Chapman was in the mix back then, although he was known as Irving Harrigan at that time.
Really?
Part of the Charlie and Harrigan show on Cliff. And then on KFJZ, 1270 AM, which, of course, we are their, or we might have been their FM sister had we existed back then. Mm-hmm. We would have been, in fact. There was Marky Baby on KFJZ, the great Mark Stevens. Those were my guys.
I don't remember guys specifically. In Miami, we had Y100, and they were kind of wacky. And I won tickets one time to a band that I know Krystina hates, and I think it was Starship. And was that an offshoot of...
The Jefferson Airplane.
Is that what it...
Yeah.
Okay. So I won tickets to Starship, but it was at the same time that Madonna was on tour with the True Blue Tour. So I knew I won tickets, and I went to the desk, and I tried to get him to...
Yeah, I won Madonna tickets.
I tried to bamboozle the front desk lady, and it was unsuccessful.
Yeah, she's like, we've never heard that before.
Yeah.
Funny.
So did you go to the Starship?
I did not go. Have I told you what my first ever concert was?
No.
At the Orange Bowl, 1986, I believe, the Boss, Bruce Springsteen.
Wow.
Born in the USA tour.
That is a good place to start, and that was a great show.
I mean, I loved it. I was 9 or 10 years old. And I remember that day my dad said to get all your homework done, like, at school, because we got something to do tonight. We had no idea. It was a total surprise. And I'm like, wasn't going to do it anyway, so okay, fine. What's the fun plan?
It's done, Dad.
And I don't know, when you're nine, do you know what the concert calendar says? I have no idea. So he loaded us up in the car. I had to talk to Vita. I guess I'm not even sure if Vita was there. I imagine she was. And we were in the car and just heading somewhere. And we took this very crowded exit with bumper-to-bumper traffic. And the car in front of us in their back window, you know, you write crap in your back window. Mm-hmm. And it said, headed to see the boss in huge letters. And we were at the exit of the Orange Bowl. And I'm like, oh, we're going to a concert?
So you knew who he was?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, born of the, you know, that's a very simple
show.
Yeah. Me, Cash, and Bill for sure. And I think Vita went as well.
A family outing.
A family outing to go see the boss at the Orange Bowl in 86. Hmm. I don't know how that came up. What were we talking about?
Where are we?
You won concert tickets.
Yeah, there you
and
go.
You're trying to get Madonna instead of the other one. Yeah. It's Friday.
You're trying to trade him from Madonna.
For True Blue tour tickets. And to this day, I've never seen Madonna, who is what? You label her as?
The number one hot babe of all time.
My man.
All right, Lenny says, the world went to S the moment Mike retired. Would he like to issue a public apology for breaking the world?
No.
Chris McCoskey, how has veterinary medicine evolved over the past two decades? Is there any hope that we are now able to fix a horse's bones?
Well, what about it, Shoopy?
There's no optimism. There is no peace. Horse's bones will never be fixed.
No justice, no peace, huh?
Nope. We love you, Barbaro. Our king. We stand.
That's right. United with you.
Our king.
Rest in power.
That did have the vibes of the original for some reason.
I don't know. Don't laugh over this. Yeah. Do not laugh.
It's just him saying Barbaro. What is it?
I really did start to get emotional when I was making that Barbaro call. The longer it went on, the closer I got to crying, because really is sad. That
it is sad.
A horsey just... He thought his life was all free and getting to run and going to just be a stud the rest of his life when he gets done and breaks one damn leg and pop.
We can't even fix it.
Pop. Right, like a puppy breaks his leg.
Right.
No pop.
Yeah. Dog gets run over and we get to fix it and bring it back. It's eating soft food by 4 hours later.
But a horse's bones, no.
No, God forbid.
Right, the horse might be worth $200,000. Yeah. I mean, Barbara's a million-dollar horse.
Horses are so much stronger. I just don't get it. I'll never understand it.
Neither will I, Shoopy.
We are not going to leave the air. Not today, but as a show. until the first successful broken horse leg is fixed and that horse runs again.
Yeah, Shoopy, you can't retire again
until we get this sorted.
We fix a horse's bones.
This time I'll just die.
And they're going to have Gruber out there. Like, there's doctors and veterinarians, and they're like, we did it. Guys.
Everybody shaking hands real solemnly.
We blankin' did it. And we're going to lift his little foot into a stirrup, and he's going to be the one that rides.
I'm
ready. Surgically repaired horse, the first.
It's like they can't even put a bionic leg or something on it.
Sure.
Just let it have a stump.
Chris says he's loving the show from up there in Indianapolis.
Whoa.
Wow.
He said, already must listen every day for me. Keep rocking, Rhines.
Yeah, Shoopy, keep rocking.
Kiss, kiss, dude.
I went to the Indianapolis 500 this summer.
Did you?
Yeah.
What was that like?
It was awesome. I'll tell you about it later. We need stuff.
Okay.
But it was incredible.
All right.
It was really good.
Don't forget it. Write it down.
Yeah, what did we say to write down at the beginning of the segment? It was something funny.
Don't remember.
Come on! We just had it.
Well, we can listen to it back.
That's the trouble. Everybody forgets stuff. That's the trouble with the world.
Larry Walker story?
Okay.
Yes.
Larry
Walker story. Okay,
right, I'm adding Indy 500
Indy 500.
Right now.
Tales from Indy. Joel J., I know you guys aren't exactly covering a ton of sports stuff anymore, But watch the Padres shock the world. They're getting no respect from the national media. This city is electric and it's fun as hell. Mike, handicap the fighting father's chance.
Would not shock me.
Really?
I would not be shocked by that. I don't know if I would say they're the National League favorite. But if you like to go in on a dark horse that presumably has all of its bones intact... That's not a bad one.
My good friend, Texas America, love this man. Favorite meat?
Ooh.
You go.
Gonna need a minute.
I'm having trouble delineating meats right now.
Understandable.
Chicken, beef, pork.
Yeah.
Well, chicken's not meat, is it?
Yeah.
Squid.
Yeah.
It is?
Fish. Oh, yeah. Squid.
Okay. Cooked. Fish. Fish for me.
Okay.
You like fish more than beef?
Yeah.
Wow. Huh.
What's your favorite fish to eat? What's your favorite thing to eat from the water?
Next week? Actually, I'm in on virtually anything that swam and had a face.
Really?
Yeah.
Including something that doesn't have a face, the bivalve mollusk.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Whenever we visit Shoopy's Raw Bar in one of our meetings,
we didn't make it all,
but we challenged Groobs to eat his first oyster.
That's right, we did.
It wasn't bad.
He didn't love it.
But kind of like skydiving, I'll do it once, uh-huh. Be able to say that I did it forever, and never do it again.
I was very proud of you for doing it.
Thank you.
Because that's a hard food
very
to
hard.
Try.
Is that the hardest?
Probably.
Yeah, if you're not ready for it.
Well, it's an acquired taste, I can tell. It's something.
Octopus? That's hard to eat. You know? Because
yeah.
You see it and you're like, oh.
But it's probably same family, like equal difficulty. Yeah. Those things are hard.
I can handle both of them.
Yeah, same.
We have a tweet from Jordan Claire Rhyner.
Whoa.
Ooh.
And I trust that this is a loaded question. Because Jordan Claire Rhyner asks, who's the coolest person you've smoked a joint with? Oh, he smiles already.
You answer that.
I read it and I thought about it. Nobody cool, nobody famous, nobody of note, but I did smoke a joint with my brother Cash's like fraternity house when Cash was in the shower before he and I had ever smoked weed together. Mm-hmm. And he was in the shower, and we were arguing, and then everyone disappeared to a back room, so I just walked into the back room, and they're all like, I try to hide it. I'm like, guys, you know, I'm in high school, I'm senior in high school or whatever. So they're like, okay. And just we all passed a joint until he walked out of the shower, and he walked in. He's like, okay, how long have you been doing this? Like a sad father.
So disappointed
like,
in you.
I'm like, chill, dude, here.
And I was just holding it for someone.
And then I think I handed it to him, and then he smoked it, and everything's fine since, but... That's my favorite passing it story, but no one famous there.
How about you?
No, no one cool or famous. That's not really my thing, honestly.
Golly, I can't think of who it is, but there is somebody out there that I smoked a joint with, and I can't remember who it is right now.
Musician?
Yeah. Athlete, something like that. Anyway, she'll tweet me here for a second, in a second, and... I'll remember.
Last one, Ryan Carter. When did the Millabout Smartly and Trice Up intro start, and how did it come about?
It came about because when I was a kid, I had cousins that were in the Navy. And once they got out, they had all their Navy stuff with them. And they had this big old handbook. And I used to read it, go over there and read it, see what it was about. And I came upon the things they say at Reveille. Mm-hmm. Every day on the ship. And Millabout Smartly and Heave To, Trice Up has always stayed with me.
It was iconic.
It's a really cool saying.
All of it.
Yeah.
And then Pot Right, Wheel 'em Around. You threw some poker in there.
Yeah, Pot Right, Wheel 'em Around.
I love it.
That's just from playing poker with guys.
Millabout Smartly.
I love it all, Michael.
Bring it back.
And I love the segment... that you two have named Big Natural Tweets.
So big, so natural.
That's not
like this.
At all.
I would put forth the idea of making this a daily myself.
Let's all step into the Sunset Lounge, and let's do that in just a moment. But first up, I got to tell you, I love my dog Simon. You love your dog Skipper or Taco or Beatrix Kiddo. But what's one bad thing about the sweet puppy dog ownership? Let's say it together. Their cold nose. So you're all warm in bed petting your dog and you feel that ice cold nose hit your arm or nudging you in the back wanting attention. Well, we at Sirois Industries have come up with a solution. The Furry Friend Warming Snout Bag, available now. Just attach two of our patented canine comfort clips to your furry friend's upper lip. And you pull the snout bag up just below the eyes, and then you cinch it. Your dog's natural breathing will circulate warm carbon dioxide over their nose, raising its temperature until it's pleasant to the touch. You will love it. Dogs seem okay with it too, perhaps. So say goodbye to cold puppy nose. Say hello to warm puppy nose with the Sirois Industries Furry Friend Warming Snout Bag. Get yours today at 971-THEFREAK.com.
So nervous about this week, and I'm like, we'll be good. I know we'll be good. And honestly, I think you guys have all that have helped us, Julie and you, and obviously Mike, man, this is, it's good.
It's fun.
It is good.
It's going to work.
I'm digging this a whole lot. This thing will take.
Boy, Mike said something. He was pumped up about something, and he said, F and A, this is the best experience I've ever had in this game, in the pre-show.
Oh, yeah?
Something came up.
It is.
And the dude
absolutely is.
You're so psyched, and I love to see it.
I mean, I've been waiting for something to go wrong or just something to happen around here. And I'm not talking about just with the show. I'm talking about with this place in general.
Yeah.
I've been waiting for something to pop up that I didn't dig, and it just has not happened. This is too good to be true, Mikey. It really is.
Well, you know what it is for me, because I've never had anything even close to this, and I'm freaking out, excited, but just being done with this week, it's like, if you did a week, you can do 51 more.
That's right.
And we're gonna.
You do 52, do another 52.
Yeah. Way more than just 51.
What, weeks?
We'll do more than that, yeah.
Yes. But for in the year.
Yeah.
And plus a ton of vacation time, as per my contract okay. states. So let's head in, shall we?
All right. The day is done. But before you head home, you need to go to that place. You know the place. It's a certain kind of place. They know you, you know them. It's a place where you can take the edge off. A place where the lights are dim. The music swings, but it's never too loud. And you don't even have to tell them when to make it a double. Where the skirts are tight and the necklines plunge. Now you might think no such place exists. Ah, but it does. It's the Sunset Lounge. Step inside the green door. Have a seat at the bar. Get in the groove at the Sunset Lounge with the Downbeat on 97.1 The Freak.
Chill.
Yeah. We have a little unfinished business from that last segment, which we must address here.
I enjoy looking at a man or woman and watching the light bulb illuminate inside their cranium. And I did have that experience during the break with my friend Mike Rhyner.
Yes.
In the previous segment, we were running through some tweets, and we got one from Jordan Claire Rhyner.
Yeah.
And she asked the question,
I know her.
Who the coolest person you ever smoked a joint with was. And the light bulb at that moment was unfortunately dim, but it was shortly after illuminated, and we have our answer. Not via text, either. You figured it out.
Yes, it's a rather old light bulb. But, you know, if you mess around with it enough and screw it in, screw it out, sooner or later it comes on.
And a moth will appear.
Yes, that's right.
A moth, you say?
Who do we got?
Well, tell me... When you think you hear the name of the coolest person I've ever smoked a joint with. This was down in Houston in the mid-70s. I believe the year was 1976. And I was down in Houston working with a band. We were playing. We had a night off. We were going to go out and check out some other bands. So we rolled into this place. And this little four-piece was up there rolling. And we had a couple of other guys who were native to the place with us, who knew their way around down there a little bit better than we did. This was a typical four-piece: bass, keys, drums, guitar. But on guitar in this band was one Christopher Cross. And Christopher Cross, in about, probably 8-10 years or so, would become extremely, extremely famous and pile up many, many big hits and hopefully, if he handled his business right, make a lot of money. But on this night, he was up there playing in this joint. And they were good. It was a nice little band. But he sounded exactly like he does today. And like he does on the records that you hear of Christopher Cross. I mean, he had that voice and sang just like he does. And he's a very good guitar player, too. He's very talented. Don't make the mistake of thinking that Christopher Cross is a lightweight, because he most certainly is not. Anyway, a couple of the guys that I was with happened to know him, or a couple of the local guys did. They happened to know him. And we were talking to him between sets, and we wandered outside. And somebody broke out a joint. Now, do you know what that is, Mike?
I believe I do.
Okay. Christina, you up on this?
No way.
Little Mary Jane.
Oh. Bad girl.
So we torch up that Buell. And we're all standing around just shooting the bull. Passing it around and everything. And up pops 5-0. Now, I was not holding it at the time, fortunately. But things were pretty rough on stuff like that in the great state of Texas back then. One of those was enough to get you hauled in, and you would wind up with a real problem on your hands back then. So I don't know who was holding it. I don't know what he did with it. I don't know if he just dropped it on the ground. But the cops rolled up, got out. Asked us what we were doing out here. I'm just getting some air, officer. No big deal. Mm-hmm. Just getting some air. Said, you guys don't have anything, do you? No. We don't do that. We don't do that. Meanwhile, there's the joint still burning down on the ground.
So they can smell it for sure.
And he looked back and said, you sure? And we told him, no, we really don't. So he says, okay, have a good night. Be careful out there. Got in his car and drove off. So the answer to the question of the most famous person that I've almost got busted smoking a joint with is Christopher Cross.
Not bad.
Pretty
Christopher
famous.
Christopher Cross. Sailing for most people would be his number one song, right?
Yeah. He had others, though. He had a really nice run there.
I'm going with
four or five big hits.
I'm seeing the Arthur theme song, Best That You Can Do.
That's another big one for him.
Because I was a big Arthur fan.
Were you?
Yeah, with Dudley Moore.
Mm-hmm.
And I even like Arthur 2, On the Rocks, which is far less successful, I believe, than the original.
They might should have left it alone after one.
Always.
Yeah, it's especially, always a good idea.
Especially Jurassic Park.
Yes.
But they did not.
Wasn't bad.
I don't know, man.
We could do the world would be the same if every other Jurassic Park was not made.
Well, maybe, but still.
Oh yeah. No, I legit love this song.
With the sunset
with
too.
The sunset, and we're in the lounge.
Yeah, we're in the lounge. How perfect could this be?
Let's just all look out the window.
Crank that.
Once in your life, find her. Someone who turns your heart around.
Oh, we've hit nirvana, Mikey. We have made it.
All chairs have been rotated toward the window.
That's right.
Legs are crossed.
That's right. We're all relaxed and stuff. All we need is the joint that was on the ground.
Give me 7 minutes.
So there's the answer to the question.
Christopher Cross, are you unaware of the movie Arthur, Christina?
Yeah, I was thinking the K-E-R-A Arthur cartoon when you said Arthur. So
what is that, like a little...
yeah,
like
the aardvark.
Chipmunk or something?
Yeah.
Aardvark, yes, with glasses.
You're so young.
Yeah, well...
Will you watch and review Arthur 2 on the rocks?
Sure.
I think you oughta.
Yeah.
I'd like to end the show today with a little something, if you don't mind.
Go ahead.
You know how intently I've been listening to our station
mm-hmm.
all week. Love it. I've loved it. Every show, very different, very unique.
I have too.
Very different from the counterparts on other stations in this time slots. It's just a whole different vibe, and I love it. I used to do this on Cirque du Soleil with my brother, where I'd intently watch everybody at the show, like who was contributing what. And I would come up with a ranking system to essentially rank how they did, how everybody did. And unbeknownst to all of you, I have been keeping that close of an eye on you, and I'd like to release the Downbeat station rankings for everybody involved for what they did in week one. Okay. Don't be nervous.
Okay.
This is not personal. I mean, someone has to be last. Someone's going to be first. I really hope no one gets mad. I feel like you guys are already like staring at me like you're going to be mad.
Yeah, find out.
Well, I'll preface it by saying everyone did great.
We made it to Friday.
But here are your station rankings. 1 through 11 for the principal people that worked on the station this week. In 11th place, and yes, dead last, we'll find Jeff Skin Wade. And I'll assume in the near future he's going to have it. But anyone who's been listening this week could tell... This week he just didn't have it.
Can I defend him as a showmate? Did you know he's
got... If you must.
He's got a weekend show that he put together. It's like 2 hours long.
Okay. Well, what does that have to do with the last 5 days of broadcasting?
He's been doing that on top of...
If in fact there is anything.
He's been doing that on top of our show stuff. He's had car issues. He didn't even have a car to get to our remote today. He had to deal with that. And he also, defeated cancer, but...
How long does he get that? Not this week.
Go ahead and put him
such
last.
Such a force field. Not this week.
Go ahead and put him last if 11th. You want to.
Sorry, he's not skin. Last. He's 11th.
Well.
And you'll see how serious this is because in 10th place I have Michael Shale Sirois.
Really?
I did fine this week. But essentially just a giant slab of Lithuanian beef that somebody sat next to a microphone. At number 8.
A giant slab of Lithuanian beef.
Okay, say that again. I'm sorry. I'll stay out.
The giant slab of Lithuanian beef.
Love you.
I'll never ask you to re-rack it, but I love that the second I heard him. At number 9 in our freak station rankings for week 1, we have the Sleeping Beauty, the Content Combine, Mr. KT Kevin Turner.
Hmm. All right.
Not bad. Top 9. We're getting toward the glory zone here. At number 8, we have the Engine, the Heartbeat. Of 97.1 The Freak. The Shoopy, Mr. Michael Gruber.
Oh, thank you.
8th.
I'll take 8.
Comfortably not being voted off any islands or out of any houses.
I'm fine.
Head down, working hard. Number 7 in the station rankings for our first week on the air. He's big, he's loud, he's very convincing, both on and off the air. And he's got the toughest dog that is apparently made of rubber that the world has ever seen. It's Ben Rogers.
And he can sell anything.
Yes.
Ben is number 7. Number 6, the unsung hero of the month, a military man whose boots hit the ground first here every day at the Freak, and he stays until the Mavericks are done. It is Mr. Matt Cather.
That dude is a king.
He is a king.
He's currently working on math stuff right now, actually, getting some clips together.
At number 5, he's succeeded in waking up early 4 days in a row now. He is handsome. He is uncut. He is Jeff Kavanaugh. Number 5 in the show rankings. For week 1. Number 4, she stepped into a very much larger role. She's filled in all over the station. She lets me kiss her.
She laced up her skates and nailed the triple Lindy, the always lovely Krystina Ray.
You would have said anyone else.
I'm like, oh, wait. Like, wait, that's got to be me.
And top three, here we go. Yep. Number three, the triumphant return, proving he's still throwing gas like his name is Satchel Paige, the wolf of all streets, Mr. Michael Rhyner.
Cool.
You're on the podium. Number two.
Thank you.
The sunshine of our station. She's gone above, beyond, and then above again. It is Julie Dobbs in second place in the station rankings. And number one, a man whose success and innovation I strive to emulate. Regional market president for iHeartRadio, Dallas, Austin, and San Antonio. Our boss, Mr. Paul Corvino.
The Corvette.
The number one contributor to our station's success, our boss, Paul Corvino. Thank you for your courage and vision as we put this thing together. That's
calling all freaks. 97.1 The Freak.
Whoops.
Oh, no.
Go ahead.
That is straight to Paul Corvino from me, Mike Sirois. Michael, talk us out of this thing.
All right. There it is. Week one is in the books. What a ride it's been this week. We appreciate you all being by the channel. Thanks to Shoopy. Just killing it over there. So good to be back with him. For Krystina Ray. For Mike Sirois. The big slab of Lithuanian beef. For all of us up here at The Freak, we do thank you for being by the channel this week. Let's do it again next week. I'm Mike Rhyner. Till then, ciao.